keep you. I certainly don't want you to have to leave. If you'd like to stay, you're more than welcome to stay. So this is the Neshoba Regional School Committee regular meeting and includes our FY17 budget hearing. Calling to order at 6 o'clock. If you took a look at tonight's agenda, as long as the rest of the school committee is okay with it, I'd like to flip the proposed functional realignment agenda item with the citizens' comments, because my assumption is that many of the folks that are in the room are here to hear about more of that. Hi, Lynn. So I think, well, if you guys are okay with that, we're going to go ahead and flip the agenda.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And I think it's important for us to allow Dr. Bates to have an opportunity to speak to his proposed realignment. I know that there have been a lot of questions and a lot of concerns. I'm going to ask that people keep their questions and concerns or any comments that you would make later on in the evening when we speak to citizens' comments about the structure and not individuals, because we can't discuss individuals. But I think there's also been a lot of information that has been proliferated on social media that is not accurate, and I don't believe that that's fair to do that. So I think that we need to give Dr. Bates an opportunity to explain what his proposal is, and this will be an opportunity for the school committee to ask questions. For the audience, if you'd like to make a statement, you can do so in the citizens' comments once we get through this portion, okay? All right, Dr. Bates.
Thanks. As an administrator, one who looks at policies, procedures, and organizational structures, I view the organizational structure based on a comprehensive approach, one that addresses the needs of all students. I looked at the organizational structure as the big picture and not individual pieces. I viewed your current organizational structure specifically in student services as missing some components, if you will. And the current structure, slide that back up. And at the top showed special education teachers and special ed, early childhood and special education paraprofessionals, early childhood coordinator, school psychologist, BCBA, which are behavioral specialists, contracted services, that's when students have to have special services contract out, and related services such as OTPT, speech and language, all viewed under special ed. And you currently have two components, guidance and social workers, that are sort of out there, and I understand 3 years ago they were sort of under a separate umbrella, but the past 3 years have been sitting there, basically. At the high school, I know they're well organized with a department head and so forth, with the middle school and the elementary schools and so forth. And so, in identifying an organizational chart, I really looked at how can we be a little bit more inclusive. So my proposal was to change the title of the Director of Special Ed, because it's not just special education, but to a Director of Student Service or Director of Pupil Services, and include the oversight of guidance and social workers. And you currently have a structure that has 504 compliance under the Director of Health and Wellness, which is a nurse. And I know that health 504 plans, the majority of them are academically oriented, although there are many that are have health pieces to it. But and even talking with your health and wellness coordinator, I think it behooves everybody that there is an educator that is focused on 504 plans. So in looking at that, to integrate into that aspect too. So the piece of the nursing aspect, I really can't delve into that, because you currently, in your district, you have a nursing grant, and you have to have a full-time nurse coordinate that grant. It's a $78,000 grant. But I learned only of that $70,000, you only get 72, because you have 6,000 that have to go out to two other school districts. And I also look at, and again, I'm not disclosing anything I haven't talked to Donna about, you know, you have a $92,000 salary that's maintaining this grant, and granted she does a lot of other things, and I don't, at this point in time, I can't discern what's a need, what isn't a need, that sort of thing. So I don't, I'm not proposing putting nursing under that category now. I know change is difficult. If many of you have ever read Who Moved My Cheese by Dr. Spencer, and the text, which is a fable, a work fable or a life fable, and cheese is what you know and probably what make you happy. And there are four characters in that book. Be like Sniff, who anticipates the quick change and likes it, or Scurry, who quickly scurries about into action and adapts to the change, or Ham and Haw, who sort of resist the change because of fears and the unknowns and so forth, and I fully appreciate that. But I'm really looking at this, I look at, I know you look at it as a major change, I look at it as a minor change, that should really not impact the delivery of students at all. It's a administrative structural change. And I, again, I go back, instead of seeing things in separate pieces, I see integrating the guidance and the social workers and the 504 under a director of student mm-hmm. services. And you currently have, I believe, 13 counselors and four social workers. So you're looking at 17 people. And as I said, the 504 piece focused on the health and wellness piece. And you can see by the chart, which we currently have, and I really would like to look at it as a cohesive piece. When I look at things whole and thinking about all children, I really look at the aspect of the circle rather than fragmented pieces. A lot of districts, and I know one district isn't better than another in that respect, but in looking at a lot of districts, they have this sort of makeup of a director of pupil services, and it runs the gamut. A lot of districts have, I received at least 51 comments from superintendents who have this sort of structure, and it runs the gamut, putting under it not just special ed, but homeless, the McKinney-Vento Act. They put under nurses. They put under ELL. So it just depends on what the needs of the district are. So it isn't something that I haven't done before. I had proposed it once before. And I look at the circle piece with the student in the middle, and seeing how all these pieces feed into looking at the child. Just as you, as many of you who may have special ed students and you sit at a team meeting, you have a gamut of people who sit around all with an expertise around the table, who you get feedback from. And I look at this, again, as an administrative structure where you're looking at the whole pieces of these important, these two other important pieces that I look at currently are missing out of that structure. As far as the other administrative pieces, which are more central office focused, we talked about before, and it's basically coordinating the business office and HR into one to oversee that. And we already talked about the instructional coordinators and just reassigning who is responsible to whom.
All right, so, hi, Mark.
Hello.
So why don't we open it up to the committee? If you have questions, Nicole, you want to lead us off?
I do.
My major, most important question is why this has to happen now, when we are not only taking these recommendations from Kurt, but we are also awaiting the results of the NASBO audit, what they say there. And then with the hiring of a new superintendent, who should have his or her option of customizing his or her administration as he or she sees fit. Mm-hmm. So should we accept these recommendations now, we will have a large, maybe not in delivery of services, but a large disruption in the central office that we will have to then again do in another year. Mm-hmm. And I think that that is showing some poor leadership on our part. That's my major concern. Mm-hmm. Aside from that, if you were going to be our superintendent,
yep.
I do appreciate this work, and I do like the coordination and filling in the certain gaps that we hear about quite often. The job is so large. Mm-hmm. It's very, very large. And the support underneath it, I can't say I know what that would look like. Mm-hmm. And that is somewhat scary.
Mm-hmm.
So do you know how that would work? Can you answer that question in a nice little sound bite?
So, like, what
well,
is about support?
The you have the pupil services,
right.
And then I'm assuming under that, like here, is the SPED along with
what
everything.
Which you currently have.
Yes. So
it's just adding in.
It's an admin that we're adding in above SPED among everybody else.
No. You're not adding another admin.
Okay.
You're just taking that, what you currently have as a structure as a director,
mm-hmm.
and making that director as the director of pupil services. That job. And under it, you're adding in the oversight of your guidance counselors and your social worker, all right?
Yes.
And the 504 compliance.
Then it does seem like we are adding quite a bit to that
right.
job.
Exactly. Yep.
And so will that job then get more more support? I mean, will
mm-hmm.
she be able to... not so much manage, but like hand off to someone. I mean, is there going to be then within that?
I can't talk about personnel. I'm
I know.
Talking about a position.
Yes, and I do understand that. But underneath that position, is there then a SPED specialist and a... I'm sorry, I have a touch screen, which is why I someone who... I know I'm not articulating myself very well, but... Everybody currently under
right.
the guidance and social workers and the nurses.
Take
the
nurses
out. We just talk about
out.
The nurse. That is now going to the pupil services.
But they're currently in
other
in,
areas.
They're in schools, right?
Yes.
But there is no coordination. They are. They're in a building
mm-hmm.
with the principal.
Yes.
And that's but there's no coordination from K-12. Your high school has your department head that's
yes.
coordinating that, but there's no one within bringing the whole piece together. So it's like meeting periodically to make sure that everybody's on the same wavelength and that sort of thing.
So who evaluates that role now?
Right now, your principal.
Would they continue to evaluate?
They're in their buildings.
I mean, that was part
but,
of the thing
also
was
with, right. But you also have pieces of coordinators that can give input if there's any.
So is it a dotted line to, I think that's.
Yes, that's,
yeah.
That's
yeah.
Thank you, Lorraine.
Yeah.
Okay, I see that.
I mean, you already have some aspects of that happening right now with, I just met recently with, the director of special ed and one of your social workers who have worked on a grant, and they're doing collaboration, they're doing a wonderful job, it's great. So you already have bits and pieces of that happening, that collaboration.
So in putting a structure like this together, you don't really see any sort of transition apparent to the students in the school? Like it's just going to be like any other?
I don't see any disruption. It's an organizational piece. It's not a delivery of service piece.
Mm-hmm.
And it's more. I believe it's more looking at the adults of having a cohesive team that can coordinate, you know, whether it's professional development or things like that, that you have that sharing piece. That's how I see it.
And if and when our new superintendent comes in here, is there flexibility in this system, or could, I know you can't read minds, obviously, and you don't know who's coming next. But this, in your experience, this setup is...
It's not anything new. It's just how it's a managerial piece.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I look at, you've got these two pieces that are, I feel are integral to the well-being of children that are just sitting out there that aren't being coordinated.
Mm-hmm.
That's all.
And currently the titles that we have in our central office will fit in this structure.
What do you mean?
Underneath?
Yes.
Here?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
He's just I think what he's saying is he's renaming that bucket.
Just the title, so it encompasses student services, not just focusing special ed, because you have, your guidance and that. The biggest piece is the 504, but 504 is right now are being utilized within your buildings, your class, your principals, and so forth. And again, I feel very strongly about the fact, and it's not a negative, I want to make that very clear, about Donna's ability. We've talked about this, and she's a wonderful person, she's great, she has great talents, but I look at 504s as someone who has had to deal with them. It's an educational accommodation. Granted, there are many times you have to have the medical, and that's when you bring in the nurse, but I really think the oversight should be an educator.
All right. Cam?
Yeah, thank you. First, anyone who's here for this particular issue tonight, thank you for coming. One of the things that we...
Neil, you got to talk to
one
him.
Of the things, one of the things that I think that we all appreciate as a school committee is the fact that we're not making decisions in a vacuum, so having people here with their opinion I think is very important. That being said, I see this as a, in my mind, correct me if I'm wrong, Doctor, is strictly a structural change within the administration.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to have any delay, any break, any differential in the services that are provided. We're still going to have individual chairs over the individual aspects of SPED.
Yep.
That doesn't change.
Change
the person that is the SPED director now would become, that role would rephrase that role would then become Dupal Services Director.
Mm-hmm.
So the auspice of the 504s, which since I've been here, there have been parents, there have been situations, and we've had several discussions about substantial gaps in the 504 process,
mm-hmm.
in the reporting structure and accountability.
Yep.
And it has nothing to do with Ms. Lindstrom at all, because she wasn't involved in that, to be very clear. But that being said, there are these gaps right now, and this is meant to address those gaps and to create the full circle.
Right.
Okay. So when you presented this last week, I wanted to personally get some more information. And so I started by simple Googles. And Google Pupil Services, and immediately there were 54 school districts that popped up. And I started calling some of these districts to actually find out what fell under this this program, what they thought of this. And I only talked to a handful of them, of those 54, but they all expressed very positive results in those changes.
Mm-hmm.
I then called and spoke with Department of Education, our district liaison,
right.
and spoke with him. And I also inquired about this. And his response was that each district is under its own purview for setting this up, as long as we meet the requirements by the state, and that person would need to be a SPED the equivalent of a SPED director to handle.
Right,
they'd have to have all the criteria to meet that. And I asked for how this works with pupil services, and he said it's been working very well. From there, long-windedly, I was referred to the Department of Executive Education in Massachusetts. And they have something called the Massachusetts Tiered System
of Support. That's what I teach.
Okay. So they referred me to that and said specifically, this is something that works right in, that was put out in 2011.
Yep.
This works right in with the theory of having complete total coverage for the student through the entire process, whether it's SPED, whether it's finance, whether it's education or whatnot.
Right.
So this, what you're suggesting, is best practice methods,
right,
something that your 40 years experience and you teach at graduate level,
yep,
that you're bringing here to the district and making as a suggestion.
Trying to.
So how can we alleviate the parents of children that have needs,
right,
that nothing will happen that will break the services or the quality, maybe increase it, of the quality services they're getting?
It's, again, I look at it as an administrative structure, not as down below. I look at it as, it's the directorship that's the piece.
Thank you. One quick sidebar. So part of my frustration over this week was we had this meeting, and then right after the meeting, there were people that wrote letters, and thank you for sending them, because they expressed their concerns, and there were things that I specifically took and delved into.
Yep.
We did have a situation where someone from the district actually got on social media immediately and started fear-mongering, as far as I'm concerned, because I had people sending me copies of these and saying, what the heck? I'm really concerned about the process, but no information about how this affects the student, what the concern is. It really focused on an individual, and I think that that has the potential of inciting parents, scaring parents, and rather than the parents being able to come here like tonight and ask questions, get answers, it creates a fear. And I find that to be belligerent, and I find it to be a cancer. I find it to be a cancer within the social media when that happens, because it tears into the district and the process of things working logically. And we should have these meetings where we're able to get together.
All right.
I'm sorry, but
that's okay.
I feel strongly about that.
Let's move on. Thank you, Mark, Kathy.
It's fine.
It's fine. Questions or comments about the structure that's being proposed?
I'll reiterate, just I feel the same way I felt last week. I did have some people approach me, some really excited about this and really saying this is filling the holes, and some saying I'm just concerned about it, I just want to know more, and I asked them to come tonight, or I sent them the links as well. I think it looks like a very sound structure. It makes a lot of sense to me, but as I stated last week, I think that the new superintendent should be given a package of the MASBO, a package of all of your insight and all of the knowledge that you're gaining for them, both which are outsiders looking in, which is just a tremendous gift to the next superintendent, and I personally don't think any changes should be done until the next superintendent.
Mark.
In the realm of superintendency, these are all in your sphere of how you or any superintendent is able to organize their administration. And in one sense, you want to support your school committee, but to what extent do you have the authority just to go ahead and move people around or reorganize the school district?
Oh, I wouldn't do that at all.
I understand that you wouldn't.
No.
I'm just asking, in terms of authority, your average superintendent has some latitude to do that. Kind of
absolutely.
Thing, right?
When you're dealing with contractual things and so forth.
Right.
Yeah. But again, in an administrative structure, there are certain positions that you just can't automatically move around without
consensus
or pieces of approval from the school committee.
Right.
What's that?
Yeah.
Lynn, do you have any comments?
I I just think that this is a really good opportunity because you come in and you have no stake in the game. It's fresh eyes. You don't have to please anybody. It's just a really cool look at what we have and where we're going, and I appreciate you doing.
Okay.
Kathy.
Okay. Again, Dr. Bates, thank you so much for all the work you've done. Anybody who has taken the time to look at his transition plan know that he's done a lot of work in the short time he's been here. I would encourage people to look at the transition plan that's in last week's meeting materials. If you've seen the document, excuse me, you'll know the depth and breadth of the work that Dr. Bates has done to gain insight into the district's strengths, needs, culture, and climate. Dr. Bates asked people he interviewed what they saw as the strengths of the district and what areas we need to work on. In reviewing the responses, I was reminded of things that were in the NEOS report and in the faculty and staff survey that the school committee conducted last year. The strengths consistently point to a strong sense of community support, high expectations for students and teachers, talented, committed, and dedicated personnel, and a sense of pride in the district's investment in students. What we need to work on included things like organization, clarity on people's roles and responsibilities, communication, and the perception of central office. Dr. Bates observed at last week's meeting that in his interviews, people often referred to central office as if it were a separate entity. Parts of the NEOS report and the faculty and staff survey also reflect a sense that people don't know what is going on in central office and why things get done the way they do. I believe that everybody at this table, everybody, are educational leaders in this district, and I think we need to move expediently to fix this. I support the plan. I'm going to speak about my unique perspective as a school committee member. For 34 years, I worked in education as a teacher, department chair, a middle and high school principal, and a K-12 director of teaching and learning. I'm also a parent and a grandparent.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay.
My life's work has been about meeting the needs of all kids and the people who love and care for them. As a school committee member, I've witnessed the impact on children and their families of a system that is not coordinated, and it breaks my heart to hear the experiences of parents of children with needs that are not being met. When I was a teacher, a principal, and a district admin, I could fix things that didn't work for kids and their families. As a school committee member, I am frustrated by a system that doesn't work for all students. My professional experience and expertise tell me that Dr. Bates' reorganization plan will provide us with an opportunity to fix things for all students. I once heard someone say that the only people who like change are babies with dirty diapers. That type of change is intended to provide comfort and relief. As an educator, I've always believed in change that leads to growth. And it's my opinion that the changes that are being proposed to the way in which we organize our systems will help us to grow in our ability and capacity to meet the needs of all students. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. I think I'm just going to add a couple. I looked at the original document that was.
Right.
Yeah. And I had a lot of questions, so I called Dr. Bates, and we had a couple conversations about it and how would it work, and specifically, I had questions about the whole thing, but then as he talked me through it, and I realized that the services that are currently in place are not changing, and the middle tier of oversight that is currently in place is not changing. It's at the highest level, we're just trying to encompass and fold the child into all of the services that may touch the child. So if that's really the case, if we're really not talking about an individual and their role, we're talking about a system of services. The other thing I think we've all talked about is how serious the social and emotional component is now, is becoming, will not go away. We're not able to feel like we are putting our arms around it, and to have learned that guidance and social workers are kind of out there on their own and not part of this, mm-hmm. to me, and I'm not an educator, I'm just a parent. That to me is, it's a missed opportunity, and the only ones that get hurt are the kids. And the only other thing I would say is, we've had the same structure in place for a long time. We know that more and more kids, and I don't even know the right words to use because I'm not an educator, but you know, you hear more and more kids that are on the spectrum, and the degree that they're on the spectrum, and it's becoming more and more prevalent. And you know, student services are not gonna, we're not gonna have fewer of them. We need more of them. We need more comprehensive services. We need to look at, you know, new ways and new things. And I'm not worried about outplacements, because if we need to send a kid to a school because we can't address their need, and it's in the budget or it's not in the budget, then the kid goes to the school. But if we don't have a program that's comprehensive enough to take care of the kids that we currently have with the resources that we currently have, then we're wasting our time. So I don't understand the drama, but I don't have a child in the program, and I'm not sitting home not having these conversations. Mm-hmm. So I can completely understand the fear, the unknown of a parent. I totally get that. To any of you, I hope that this helps explain what it is that's being proposed. I would ask you one question. If this section of the chart mm-hmm. is doable, mm-hmm. and not by Hercules,
right.
I need to know that. I need to know the probability or the percentage or whatever, give me something, because I need a number, that explains to me that that can be done in the current environment if we went with this change, and if we needed to add support, fine. If we need to look at what people are currently doing, and maybe they're doing things that are not direct to the student, mm-hmm. so there's a lot of busy stuff that we could strip out of their roles and devote more time. I need to know that. Yep. So I'm done.
I don't know whether this is out of line or whatever, but I'm more than happy to recommend that you don't vote on this yet.
Oh, I don't think we can. Okay. I mean, as long
and
as
I'm
everyone's okay.
I'm more than
okay.
happy to sit down and have coffees or whatever, and if it helps people to understand, I'm more than happy to do that.
So, you didn't answer my question.
Oh, I'm sorry. Looking at structures?
That's okay.
All I can tell you is that you can't make a blanket statement, because it depends on the person.
But is this, when you talk to your 51 districts, and this is typical of what they do?
They might be another clerical piece in there, but overall, yeah.
Oh.
And again, it just depends. I mean, for some of them that add in McKinney-Vento, which is the homeless, they add in the ELL piece, mm-hmm. you know, they put everything under that. I'm not recommending that. That's a whole different animal, shall we say. But.
Okay. All right. All right, I think what we should do, folks, is we probably need to, I'm going to recommend we don't vote on this. And I think we need a little bit more time to get into our communities, talk to folks in your community. Maybe we can, Alita, Dr. Bates, I think if you guys can figure out a time
yep.
within the next week, because I think we are going to have to make a decision on Thursday.
Sure. Yep.
I think, and the other question is, before I go on to there, what impact does the structure have to the budget?
Right now, it's cost neutral because you have some contractual issues. Not issues, you have a contractual obligation.
Okay.
We have a contractual, okay. So we have, so right now this structure, so you, in other words, you did not put the structure together to reduce spend in the budget.
I can't.
Why did you put the structure together?
I'm looking at pieces. And when you look at pieces, there has to be a whole. And I go back to just my background and looking at the whole child. That's me. And, you know, it's, as you said, I don't have a stake in this, but I do have a stake in it. Because it's my reputation.
And it's our kids.
It's kids. It's all about kids.
Yeah.
And it sounds trite and so forth. And I've always said, my 41 years, now 43 years in education has always been a ministry for me. So I look at children, and I look at services. And again, things have changed dramatically in 43 years and the need. And I'm just looking at, again, it's an administrative structure for me, looking at how can we have someone who can focus on the full picture rather than running over here for this piece and running over here for this piece and that piece. I also look at it, again, administratively, in a financial manner, when you're trying to develop your budget and looking at, is there someone here who can see the full picture of needs? Again, not running over here to ask this one, not running over here. And I feel badly that you have these two groups of people who I really believe should be sitting at the table. And I think on their own they're doing a lot, but I still think that the district owes it to them to have somebody in there helping them. So.
Okay. Oh boy, Kathy.
I appreciate your offering the coffees. I think that's a great idea. If that's the case, how far out can we push this? If it's budget neutral, does he have to have his coffees between now and next Thursday night?
Do you?
Do you?
Well, no, I need some guidance.
No.
Well, only because it's cost neutral right now, so when does it become not cost neutral?
No, it's not. I think you just said that. When does it not become cost neutral?
Well, he says right now it's cost neutral.
Right.
So
right.
To actually shift over to the new, what you're proposing, it's not going to cost us anything.
That's what he said, yeah.
But when, is there a time when if we waited it would not be cost neutral?
Oh, you mean if we wait? Well, I don't know if it's about money or if it's about efficient service and comprehensive service. I think that's what I'm hearing. I don't think it's that if we wait, we're going to end up spending more money. We have a structure that's been in place for over a dozen years, and kids, adults, people have moved light years in 12 years in some of the things that they're dealing with, and I think that our program does a good job of putting its arms around that as best as it can. But there are pieces that need to come into the fold on behalf of the student. I think that's the goal. Neil.
So two things. Instead of coffee for each and every person, maybe if you could do like set up a Q&A for people.
Yeah,
sure. So people
are you trying to save money in the budget again?
This is neutral. And then the other thing is I want to apologize for my strong reaction to the social media thing. We spend a ton of time on this school committee between the different subcommittees and so forth, a ton of time in our homes researching things, trying to make the best decision for the students, the teachers, the towns, and all that time, all that effort, if people would listen and get the answers and ask the questions, I think we'd be so much better off. It is so easy to just pound something out and send it out there, and it negates all that work that everyone has done and creates a real problem that we now have to spend a lot of time, a lot of effort, addressing and overriding rather than moving the district forward the way that we need to. And I apologize for kind of losing it on that, but I'm very sensitive about
that. That's all right. I think the bottom line is that every one of us has invited people to contact us and ask questions, and we will get you the information. If we're not in an executive session, which means we can't talk about it, we will give you the information.
We've made everything available, so I'm not even going to talk about that anymore because it doesn't need to be said. Contact us. Let us know. I had a couple phone calls this morning. Parents called me. Thank you. Yes, I want to hear from you. Send your emails.
Can I just say, though, I heard from parents because of what was going on social media. And so I don't think we can just blanket. Well, we obviously don't have any control. You know, these are adults and other people.
But I don't want to talk about social media. I don't want to talk about social media. Let's move on. Let's move on. All right, so the bottom line is it urgent?
Oh, I just want to know what the plan is.
I'm getting there.
Is that what you're doing?
Okay, so the bottom line is I think we're going to not vote on this. I think we'll, I completely appreciate your expertise. I appreciate that you saw a need in our district and that you looked at it from the view of the student. And I think we need to wait until next week. And I think we do have to vote on this in our budget. I think we need to have an answer. So, Kathy, what is it?
I just want to ask if you're going to do a Q&A or...
Well, we can't decide it now.
I have to look at my calendar.
Oh, okay. I don't want to... I can't believe what you've done in the time you've been here.
Right. In 8 weeks.
You're so generous with your time and your...
All right, we're going to move on now. We're going to move on. Okay, so I think maybe Dr. Bates and Alita, and then you can get some type of an announcement up on the site.
That's fine.
We'll let people know. Okay. All right. Thank you for that. All right. So now we're going to jump back on the agenda. I don't know what I did with mine. And we're going to take citizens' comments. Okay. So I'm sure. Before we do that, I'm going to do some ground rules. I know we've done this before when we've taken citizens' comments. Okay. So there's citizens' comments on every agenda. I'm going to read you pieces of the policy so that you don't think it's just me, that it isn't actually the policy. We're governed by a couple of policies here. The one that's most important is policy BEDH, which is on conducting school committee meetings. School committee meetings are meetings, business meetings of the school committee, which means that if we don't have conversations with the public, it feels like they're just not going to include us, and that's not it. That's not the point of the meeting. The meeting is a business meeting, which is different from our town meetings. And when we go to our town meetings, we get up to the microphone, we ask a question, we have a dialogue, but this is not that. If it were, I would open it up. In a school committee meeting, the citizens' comments portion is a chance for anyone who wants to provide input on what they think or how they believe, or what they want to share with the school committee, to do so. But it's not an opportunity to engage us in dialogue. It's a chance for you to tell us so that we can hear it, and then we take that information, and we use that information as we have further discussions or we make our own decisions. Okay, I just want you to understand that. Typically, we limit, and it's been this way for a while, citizens' comments to 5 minutes. In our policy, each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. I've extended it to 15 minutes today so we can take up to five policies, up to five speakers. We are going to time you because we do want to give those five people an opportunity to speak, and I'm going to ask Lynn Coletti to time us. Okay, real quickly, please direct your comments to me. Improper conduct and remarks cannot be allowed. This is from the policy. Abusive remarks are always out of order. We cannot, especially in this instance, we cannot hear complaints, concerns, criticisms about an individual, whether that's a teacher or a school committee member or the director of special education. It's not about an individual. We can't let you do that, okay? Because we can't do that either. You definitely can't talk about students. And then the other thing is, I'm going to ask if one person gets up and has a flavor of their comments, if you want to make the same or similar comments, please think about that, because we want to make sure that we hear a broad base of opinion. So if your comments are right in line with the person before you, maybe consider giving someone else the opportunity, okay? All right. How many people want to speak tonight? 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Herb Cabral, could you stand up and tell us your name and your town, even though I just told everyone? Please, come on and talk to us.
I found that the last time I was here, someone was standing here, I really couldn't hear behind.
Well, you want to come over here or stand right there?
I would do that.
But you've got to address us? That would be great.
So I am Herb Cabral. I live in Bolton, Mass. I have a student in the transitions classroom. I guess I just have a couple comments here tonight. And I'll add, Dr. Bates, thank you for all your work here. We certainly appreciate, as an interim guy, how much you really embraced the role here. Also, how well you're working with the school committee. That's great to see, and we just hope to get that in the next superintendent as well. My son has had some really great services here. We've employed neuropsychologists to evaluate him, education consultants to evaluate him over the course of multiple years while he's been in the system. And we have gotten some really great input from them based on the quality of the program here. My real concern is anything that would take a special needs director's attention away from the kind of program that's being run here is my biggest concern. And also another concern I have is, and you pointed out earlier, where we have a new superintendent coming in to make kind of decisions like this prior to a new superintendent coming in, I think is a little concerning. I'm wondering if actually the school committee might even have the whether it's your guys' place to do that, not criticizing, just whether it's your place to do that or not. So I just wanted to get that out and make sure that you guys know you have a really good special needs program here and we're lucky the most. So
thank you. Thank you for sharing that.
Thank
I really
you.
Appreciate that. Awesome. Thanks for coming. I saw a couple of the hands.
Mary. Hi, I'm Mary Lee York. I'm a parent in Stowe and I have three boys in the system. I have a couple comments. The first one is when I look at that structure, well, first of all, I appreciate what you've done. It's a lot of work. I want you to understand that a lot of us do feel a little bit defensive and worried because we just had a slightly contested changeover of our former superintendent. And then most of us have lived long enough to know that when you reorg, there's usually layoffs. And so it's hard not to view it as kind of a backhanded way, possibly, to get rid of people. And I don't mean to be inflammatory saying that, but I've seen that happen. I'm an educator myself. I've seen that happen in a school system. I've seen it happen in business. The second thing I want to say is I'd like to second what Kathy Tier said at the last meeting, and again, where I do appreciate what you've suggested, but I would like to wait. The third thing is we really haven't talked about the fact that we seem to have eliminated the assistant superintendent here, and I think we have a great assistant superintendent, and I don't know whether you see his role as kind of being a different role here, maybe the director of, I'm looking here on my phone, the human resources and finance all in one, but I'm nervous about that. And what was my third point? I forgot my third point, but I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
All right, thank you. Thanks so much. I see your hand.
Nancy Fleming from Stowe, and I am a parent of two Nishoba graduates and a former school committee member and chair. And there is some overlap here, but you only have four speakers, so I'm going to go ahead. Dr. Bates, you stated the proposals such as you're suggesting usually come from information collected over a year of observation. You put forth your proposal for reorganization of our senior level of management after 7 weeks on the job. This, to me, suggests a sense of urgency. Now, if that is correct, what is the nature of the urgency? Is this something that you've decided to do on your own? Were you tasked with a high-level reorganization by some members of the school committee? And was this ever discussed at a school committee meeting prior to February 25th? Do you know whether individuals who are currently in the affected positions have the necessary credentials to qualify for director positions in your proposed reorganization? If they do not, will we lose the entire senior management of this organization along with their institutional knowledge and systems expertise by June 30th? To whom will you go to for advice and information as you continue to learn to navigate this $55 million enterprise? Do you know if there's a viable pool of candidates to fill these director positions as you have written them? Do you expect to find 1 to 3 people you will need by June 30th? How and by whom will the search for these people be conducted? Please consider that leaving a new superintendent with a new and possibly incomplete senior management team puts him or her and the district in a precarious position. As a matter of professional courtesy and to avoid such disruption, I urge you to allow the next superintendent to make these decisions as any CEO would prefer to do. With respect to the position of assistant superintendent, the district introduced this position in late 2002, early 2003, and it's made all the difference with respect to our continued success and financial stability. In any reorganization, this position should remain. We're a $55 million enterprise with 500 employees serving 3,000 students. By every measure, we're doing well and we've earned our excellent reputation. I ask you to please be careful regarding the decisions that you make. And I look forward to hearing your answers.
Okay, thank you. Any other comments? Does anybody else want to make a comment? Yes.
I would just like to repeat.
Can you tell me who you are?
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay.
My name is Kathy Petter. I live in Stowe. I have 3 children. 2 are in the system. 1 is at Hale. 1 is at Neshoba. I'm extremely concerned that so many changes are happening so quickly with so little information being disseminated to the community. I feel that the superintendent change happened in a blink before the community had a chance to make any comments about it. I appreciate the thought, energy, and details that have been put out here in this proposal, but I think as a community, we deserve to have the opportunity to make our voices heard and to find out more about it before it becomes implemented as a change. I'm horrified by the idea that you would vote on this by next Thursday. Absolutely horrified. I read the paper and it's very hard to get information about changes like this. It just takes time. I'm usually somebody that wants things to move along, so I'm stunned that I'm the one that wants you to slow down, but it's too fast. Much, much, much too fast. This is the first time I've even seen you in person. So please slow down.
Okay.
I appreciate your
Tracy Rhodes.
your explanation of the pupil services position. The one that I was actually more that I would hope you would explain equally well is the new consolidated position of finance and personnel.
Yeah.
Because the skill set, you know, upon, you know, in my opinion, are very different. So either at one of these coffees or the next information session, if you could go into the level
sure.
of detail as you did the first, sure. that would be helpful.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. All right. One more.
Amy Keough from Stowe. Nice to meet you as well. Thank you for your time and efforts in the school committee meetings and as the interim superintendent. My concern is regarding, I certainly have no question about your background and your history in working in education and can appreciate that you've got lots of experience. My concern is your vested interest in our district as an interim superintendent and making changes that will be far-fetched as the interim superintendent. And again, with no disrespect to your experience and your background, but concerned that as has been stated earlier, a new superintendent wanting to come into the district and make decisions about what is, you know, what changes could be made.
Yep.
You know, somebody who the district has determined would be a long-term
exactly.
person. Yep. So that would be a concern, I think, that others may share.
Okay. You know what? I said one more, but come on. I really,
one
more, because we really have a lot to get through. We have a budget meeting, so please.
It's very quick.
Yes, please.
Lori Colby.
Yeah.
I have a son here at the high school in the transition program. I'm just not clear why it has to be voted on by next week.
I'm going to double check on that. I actually, while Mrs. Keough was talking, I made myself a quick note. I'm going to contact.
That seems like the $24 question here.
Yeah, I'm going
to.
I'll find out. And the question for me is, because it doesn't have implications in the budget,
right.
So that's why I'm going to make my phone calls. So
because that's very uncomfortable. I think that's what everybody's feeling, just getting to learn more about this, but why does it have to be quickly? It doesn't feel right.
Right, and again,
it's a huge decision.
And, right, and so I'm going to get in trouble for having a conversation with the lawyer, but we're good.
Okay.
You and I are good. Okay, so thank you all. I will say, for those folks who said they haven't, you know.
You're more than welcome to come to school committee meetings. I know they've been really long over the past few months. We're getting really much better at it. we don't have to cover as much ground, actually. And they're always on Bolton Access TV or Stowe TV, and we keep pretty detailed minutes, and feel free to address those minutes as well. It's also on YouTube.
And if I could say something,
there you go.
We know that the committee schedule is not very friendly to parents. So we know that it's hard to get here. Correspond with us any way you can. It's very, very important.
Okay. We're in a good place. Let's move on. So thank you for everybody who came for that section of the agenda. I think so I'm going to give you a couple minutes to leave if you'd like to leave. What? No, we got a lot to do. But great idea. okay, so the next section, and we're quite behind the agenda, is the presentation of the FY17 budget. Say again? Two people left. So school committee, this is for George and Dr. Bates are going to present the proposed budget. This is for us to have a conversation. We're pretty much close to the end, so if there's a burning desire, bring it up. If you have questions of clarification on the document, bring it up. And then when we get to the portion in the agenda for the budget hearing, we'll open it up to the floor for folks to ask their questions. Okay, Mr. Keaton.
Okay, so this is a general overview of the FY17 Neshoba Regional School District budget as it presently stands. So just some general budget goals that are in place as we went trying to put this budget together was revenue stabilization, preservation of direct instruction services, and identification of future restructuring opportunities in order to make us more efficient and more cost effective. So right now, the budget proposed stands at $54,136,033. That's an increase in our budget of $1.493 million, or only 2.84%. This, however, reflects the assessment increase of $1,724,000, or 4.35%. In very round numbers, the district's budget revenue comes about 80% of it from town assessments, and about 20% of it what we call local revenues. The vast majority of our local revenues are state funds, such as Chapter 70, regional transportation, that type of thing. Those numbers, for the most part, are flat. And this year, they actually go down a little bit. So on an annual basis, usually, most of the increase needed for our budget comes from the assessment side of the budget, usually. That's why the assessment percentage increase goes up, in this instance, higher than the budget percentage increase. And in general, that's the case this year. It's exacerbated a little bit because of the fact we have some non-reoccurring revenue that's not available to spend this year that we spent last year. So therefore, that number, the differential of that number is even a little bit more. So if you look at over the 10-year budget history, you see that since 2008, what the budgets went up, and it's been, I apologize, hard to see, I suppose, but this presentation is available on the website of the school committee meeting, if anybody would like to look at it closely, because there are some charts in here that are busy and they will be a little hard to see from a distance. But it shows you a range of budget increases, a high in 2008 of 6.7% to a low in 2011 of 0.1%. The average over the 10 years has been $1.4 million or 3.25%. This year, the dollar increase is right around the average, which obviously the numbers get bigger over the year, so the average number is going to be more in the middle, but the percentage increase is actually already a decent amount below our average. So, and just look at it graphically a little bit, you can see that it just gives you an idea, what the differences have been. They've been, dramatic. In recent years, though, as you see, probably the last five, reasonably close, and staying with the percentage chart, which is on the next page. we had some outliers at the end, at the left side, both high and low, when the 2008 financial crisis hit, and after that, it's been somewhat, the 2-3-4 range over that period since, the average being at the very same. So the highlights in this budget, and there's not a lot of new things clearly in this budget, are the addition of a sped teacher at the high school. We're looking still at the transition of the department head role at the high school, and that is funded here. A continuation of the second year of our grade 8 one-to-one program. An overall sustaining of our district technology purchases. And there's a reduction of 2 teachers and 4 paraprofessionals due to enrollment reasons. No other reasons for that. We do have compensation increases that we're obligated to for FY17. In this budget, as we discussed and approved last week, all non-union staff are budgeted at 2% increases. All Unit A staff are in the final year of our 3-year contract at 2.5%. And all Unit C staff are at 2.75% in the final year of the 3-year contract. There's been a question in the past about where staff, and I know this is hard to see, but this is where staff is placed on the steps in the district, anticipated for FY17. So our present staff advanced to the next step, so to speak, for FY17. Many of our teachers are almost, actually more than half, or right around half, a little more than half, are on step 13, which is our top step. So they will not get, there's no step raises for those teachers.
George?
Yeah.
But they do get a longevity raise, right?
Some of them, a lot of them do, yeah, $150 a year, $200 a year, yes.
So it's apparel. It's not like they're getting nothing.
All right, well, let's come back to that thought, Lynn. Let's let George finish up, and then we'll ask the questions.
So we had a question a while ago about a couple weeks ago. It was Kathy about the step increases in the chart, and that's what the chart looks like. So if you look at this chart, the step that people are stepping into, so to speak, that's the step raise that they would receive.
So George, can you just take a quick, do a quick overview of how it works?
Yes, so if you were on a bachelor's step, 7 this year.
Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
And then you become a step 8 next year, so you get a 4.41% step increase going on to that step.
And that includes the contractual obligation of the 2.5%.
That would be also included, right?
So that's included in there.
No.
It's not.
No, that's the step.
Okay, so that's important. All right, I'll let you continue.
Okay. So if you go, the total cost of our contractual and step raises is $1,013,000, and the total cost of our insurance and benefits increases are $356,000. So from the number I showed you a few pages back, you can see that's a lion's share of the increase in our budget this year, which makes sense. We're a human resources business. That's our product, and that's our cost. So these are our class size projections for the 2016-2017 school year. Per school and per grade, K-8. as you see, there's a wide range amongst the schools. Again, this is on our website, if anybody wants to look at this particularly closely. And one thing that we like to do is take a look at our expenditures based on a comparison to other districts. And it's basically like an odd group of districts, and to me, to a certain extent, it is. But the reason they were picked is those are our DART districts. The DART is the state's comparison program amongst districts, and these are the ones they picked for us. And so you can see our per pupils. In these districts, we have one of the higher per pupils, but I think it's important to mention and point out that we're still well below the state average per pupil of $14,900. These are the brand new FY15 numbers. But again, it's who we compare against and what our per pupils are. And as you see, there's not a very broad range between several of them. So they're all, a lot of them are in the very same neighborhood. One question that comes up a lot is our per pupil, so to speak, the percentage of our per pupil that goes on administration, instructional leadership. These are categories that are picked by the state in the state reporting, okay? So there's about 8 or 9 categories and the per pupils are broken down to. So that $14,000 thing you saw is broken down into various categories that we report for the end of the year report. One of them is called administration and one is called instructional leadership. The reason I combine these two together for this example is that you see the two categories are a little different among each other. And some of that has to do with, this is one of the downsides of state reporting, even though everyone tries to do it well, and our end of the year report, which we have to file each September, is audited. So if someone comes in, actually an outside auditor comes in and looks at it to make sure we report properly. Different districts report different things sometimes in slightly different categories. And the problem with that is that can skew the comparisons a little bit. So in this particular area where administration is one, instructional leadership is another, I combine them both together because some people report different things in those different two categories, but they're generally related. So I looked at this in the total per pupil for that area. Anyway, right,
we have some questions
after he's done.
Okay. And I'm almost done. And just another category we pulled out was per pupil cost for pupil services. And pupil services include things like transportation, nursing, those types of services are not direct instructional services and not special education services, but just pupil services, transportation, nursing, food, lunch program, a couple of programs during pupil services. And again, you know, there's a couple at the top that are relatively low, and we tend to be in the higher end. But I would also point out, if you look at this, only two of the districts on our state-selected DART comparison communities are regional school districts. And when it comes to things like transportation, that has a difference because of the fact we tend to have broader areas and things like that. So the two regional school districts are towards the top cost in this area. Now, we do get reimbursed for regional transportation where single districts do not, but that would not be reflected here. This is just a reflection of the cost.
Excuse me, just a point of clarification, that $14.49 is in addition to the basic $14,264. So the per pupil cost for students.
This is part of these are all part of the $14,264. Okay, they break them out in different categories.
Just to be clear.
And Kirk just asked me to break out a couple of categories to give some examples.
Thank you.
So that's what these are. So if you broke out every category, which I didn't do for the purpose of this presentation, it would add up to the $14,000.
Okay.
So those are the ones I did for now. There are other ones you can do, but I thought some of these were somewhat instructive. So.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you for doing that. And this year, I really appreciate the extra effort to give us a more, a broader picture of the budget, some aspects of it. Before I take questions from you folks, George, a question for you. Could we put the tables, the last three tables in the back, in the same order? I don't care if you use alphabetical or...
They're in numerical order, cost order.
But it's hard to compare. I don't know, is that the way you guys want to see?
From least expensive to most expensive. I can put them in any order you want. But they're right now, they're from least to most expensive.
Each one. Mm-hmm. Right. Except for Hamilton Wenham. Except for the first one.
Right, that was.
That's alphabetical order as it's reported by the site.
It's confusing.
Which one isn't in
so,
the,
so
which one isn't in dollar order?
District per pupil expenditure.
The per pupil is.
No, oh, I'm looking at the, all right, I'm looking at the numbers too.
Oh, yeah, look
at the
total,
yeah, I am.
I'm looking at the FTEs.
Look at the per pupil.
They're all in numerical.
Oh, all right.
Well, I can change the order any way you'd like.
No, don't. Oh, you put the total for the, okay.
For the instructional leadership, it's on the total.
All right, now I'm looking at one column then.
Yeah,
okay, all right, I take it back. And as far as the question on DART,
yep.
Dr. Bates, what's your opinion on that?
Well, it's what the state does. They choose them for you based on a number of like categories. And so.
It's because it's, I think.
I know you always, I've heard since I've been here, you compare yourselves to
Acton Box.
Well, and I think, you know, presenting this at town meeting, people, parents are going to want to see surrounding districts or districts that we like to compare ourselves to. I think that would make more. More sense to them.
Because
this
in
is
addition to this.
Do you want to add a couple? Yeah, I'd rather add
addition,
this.
Yeah.
We have to decide who we
yes.
we have to accept who we are. And if this is who we're compared to, and we're, you know, we aren't Concord Carlisle, then maybe add.
But look at your FTE of pupils.
Right.
You know, are you going to compare yourself to AB?
So I guess we need to get it together on that. I mean, what do you, is it a reality check? What is it?
It might be a reality check, but just speaking for the parents that I hang out with, we would like to compare ourselves to different districts.
So
this
give us three districts and we'll, and George will add it in.
Well, we had a list. It's
yes.
not in this notebook, it's in the notebook.
It was Lincoln, Sudbury, Acton, Boxborough, Concord, Carlisle.
I think it was like Algonquin.
And Algonquin.
Yeah.
Algonquin is a good
one. There was some other.
And that was it.
But what are we looking at as the basis for comparison? The basis of comparison
this is
it's around the area of ELL, high needs, things of that nature. So this, based on that criteria, could be valid. But what do we want to use as the basis of criteria? Do you want to use population? That's what we have to decide, and it would make sense to compare ourselves to regional school districts, and then what are the other basis for criteria?
So I just want to be good, because when you compare yourself to Lincoln Sudbury, you're comparing yourself just to the high school.
Right, no, so a K-12.
K-12, so you want to look at Lincoln, Sudbury.
But they're not a region, so I would think.
No, I know. So
yeah.
And
you
know what? We're not. But they're not.
I know they're
not
us.
That's unrealistic.
But what do we want to compare? I think that's it. We don't like the comparison of DART, but I think it's maybe too late in this budget process. But maybe we decide moving forward what the basis of comparison is. And how do we want to compare ourselves?
So that was the question that we've been asking, and I think that this, for this year, is a good suggestion, a good way to go,
yep.
Unless everyone has a burning need and I want to move on to pick two or three. Kathy, what are your thoughts?
This is what the state
this is what the state uses.
It's so amazing. Hopkinton got top 250 in the U.S. this year.
And Westford is a...
And Westford, right.
Yeah.
So we need to start... being who we are,
cool.
And now who we want to pretend to be. I mean, and that's great and all, because it's always good to have aspirations, but.
Well, then can we just use these districts for every competition?
That's the point.
Yes.
That's why we're doing this now, because this is who we need to compare ourselves to for the budget and for everything else, instead of using this shifting list of districts, right? Which
right,
is what's
I see that. And the lack of regional representation on this list is the only thing that.
So, Dr. Bates, are there two or three other districts that you enjoy? Somebody, give us a couple
of regionals?
Because I think that's a point we'll take.
We have a K-12 regional.
Yeah. All right. Thank you. Thank you for doing that. Okay. Now, folks, school committee.
Can I put one other thing out on DART, too, because we take this information here, something solid to work with, and then the citizens can then go online, they can look at DESE, they can look at anything else,
yeah.
And all of those comparisons are going to be made to these schools.
Right.
DART. If we hold ourselves up to some standard that no one can then compare to, we can start making up wonderful things about how we're the best school district in the state, or we're this or that, but we're not looking at the real statistics,
right,
and looking at the real issues that we need to address.
Right. Okay. Thank you for that. All right, let's talk about the budget. Mark, why don't you kick us off? Questions? Thoughts?
At this moment, I don't have any particular questions.
Okay. Any input? Desire? I don't want to put you on the spot, but if you're good, I'll pass.
I'm fine, yeah.
Kathy?
I don't have any additional questions. I feel like the budget book that we've gone through in the last few meetings was incredibly comprehensive. George, I love the narratives at the beginning. I think they tell such a huge story of why everything is the way it is this year. And I think this presentation on top of that is very helpful as well.
Thank you. Kathy?
Just some questions, because I haven't done this at this level before. Is that there were some things that we talked about and that I think we agreed to that I don't see there. Like when we talked about the high school department chair, we mentioned what the, we talked about backfill of two positions. I don't know if that is supposed to be here, or it's not in this presentation, but it certainly, we've had a lot of conversations about it, so there's that.
Yeah, it's in the bottom line.
Which one?
The one I just gave you at the beginning here.
Which, where?
Oh, are you, she's looking for it on this deck. She's looking for it.
I don't have it. I have it on, I'm looking at what we had. So what slide is it on?
Well, I mean, it's mentioned in there and it's in the bottom line.
But wait, it's mentioned in the, but it says transition of department head role at high school, right?
Yeah.
What it involves in terms of additional FTEs, we don't put that in?
I just was doing a summary, but it is in the budget as it stands.
So maybe if it is going to be an add, we should probably put it in here, right? In the budget highlights with the other positions that were.
Yeah, sure.
I think, is that what your request?
Well, there are things that we talked about that I think are in the budget that I don't understand why they wouldn't be part of this that represent a bigger picture about transitions and things that are changing. Like, we're going to transition the department head role at the high school.
Yep.
That is going to require, we use the term backfill, to free up the chairs of a, I think we said 0.4 math and 0.2 science.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. I mean, that's what I'm asking. The level of detail, the picture that you want
We can do that. This is just a highlight package. This isn't the budget itself, but we certainly can do that.
So
but
this
I think,
is the
I
highlight
think,
package. What do people, and I don't know, what do people see at town meeting? Is this what they see?
Well, in the past, we've always put the full budget online, which has all that. We haven't done that yet. I mean,
we're going to work on the town meetings to get the town meeting presentation together. But wait a second. But if your point is that you want to call out the additional FTEs for the department heads at the high school and the IT specialists that are being added back in at the middle schools, then I think that makes sense.
I think so. I think.
Yeah, but the ITs are not in the budget. The budget is only in what we voted last week.
I don't think we voted.
We didn't vote the budget.
We didn't vote.
We didn't vote last week. We talked about aspects, very slide.
You went line item by line item and said, yes, put this, yes.
Yeah, this was like reductions.
Right, so those reductions or changes
are
reflected in that number. Every change that you voted last week is reflected in that number.
Right, but the reductions are subtractions. The pictures that we want to give about what is being added.
I thought we were adding.
You know, we're adding the department. We're adding a 0.4 math and a 0.2.
Yes, that's in the budget.
And there, there are other things that, so where does, we talked about adding back in the ITs.
We talked about the ITs.
Yeah.
I talked with both principals because I wanted to get their input on what they specifically would like.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know if you want to speak to yours, but I can speak for Laura Friend, mm-hmm. and Laura Friend said she would specifically like to see the IT for her building,
mm-hmm.
If that's possible.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, I think that's fine, but I agree, but it's not in the budget right now. It's not in that number. I just emailed you the budget that is what you've had, plus the changes last week. The only changes in the budget so far, since the proposed budget, are the ones you voted for last week.
So I'm sorry to be so dense.
No, it's okay.
I'm sorry.
It's fine.
I have to agree with Kathy. I'm a little bit confused on this here because we had a conversation specifically, a heated conversation about kindergarten teacher, for instance, the proposed elimination of a kindergarten, and Lorraine and I were very much against the elimination of that, and then we talked about, but we didn't vote on, the understanding that this would not mean a job elimination,
uh-huh.
And that this was just going, they were going to be working somewhere else or whatnot, so we're going to shift, but we also did talk about two IT people I know in order to meet. That was a specific conversation, and that was on the papers. I'm not seeing, I think that's what Kathy's saying, is we're not seeing that reflective here.
I didn't see it on any papers. I mean, it was the only paper we worked off of.
It was in your suggestions. It was.
It was in the proposal, in Kurt's proposal.
Right.
And we did discuss it.
Right,
we discussed it, but it wasn't voted on. We can put it in.
You voted on anything.
You voted on that entire list.
Well, yeah, but I guess what I'm getting at is that we want to give a picture of you know, you want to, if there are changes, it would be good for people to see. You know, someone got up tonight and talked about this, the fear that people are going to be caught. I mean, I heard, and I live in a retirement home, basically, I heard people talking about six people that were going to be fired. I don't like that. It's not true. And so if we can paint an accurate picture of what is happening, I think it's more positive and optimistic. I think we did a lot of work to talk about how to optimize services for kids, but also in terms of addressing some of the issues. The big issue with the high school, with overcrowded math classes and adding the 0.4, I don't remember saying thumbs up to the adding a SPED teacher. I don't remember that.
Okay.
But it's in there. So I guess.
Let me just explain the process to where we are today. You can do anything that the committee wants to do, okay? So originally, we proposed a budget about 3 or 4 weeks ago, right? We gave you the book.
Yes.
It had the budget in it. It was around a 5% increase, okay? Then the week after, we made small adjustments, just the new Chapter 70 numbers, things like that, okay? Then we discussed 2 weeks ago, I think, I can't remember what, yes, 2 weeks ago, the memo I sent with potential other reductions.
Got it.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
We voted those reductions last week. We went through them one by one, we discussed them, and we voted them.
We agreed to them, but yeah.
Agreed to them. I thought you voted them. Okay, agreed to them.
So
I then incorporated those into the budget, okay? Because you guys said, okay, those are the numbers that are up there. We can incorporate anything else you want to, but all I'm stating is, I understand that we've talked about the IT, okay? But we haven't, and I don't want to speak for Kurt, but I don't think either one of us are under the impression that it's in the budget yet. We can put it in the budget, but it's not in the number that's up there. I just sent you a copy of the budget, so it is not in the budget.
That's not my recollection.
Well, and fine, if everyone thinks they put it in, we can put it in.
Kurt, can you jump in and level set all of us? I just put you on the spot.
No, you did put me on the spot. I believe in my plan that I presented that the focus would be in instituting the two IT people.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted the opportunity to talk to the two principals to see specifically, again, a need base, because I had not sought input from each one of them.
Yeah.
It was a discussion here. And again, I wanted to make sure if a principal really didn't feel strongly about it, I wanted to report that. Mm-hmm. So in talking to both, each one had a different opinion. And I want to support it down at the building level of what they would like.
Mm-hmm. So how did we get to this point where we thought we were going to have these two IT people added and they're not?
Actually, I don't have any, we had no numbers attached to those titles. And so therefore, in my view, we haven't had any discussion whatsoever about
adding
them.
Okay, well, now's the time. Now's the time. Wow, that's, what's the cost on the two IT people?
You look at your master's five.
About 61K.
So 120,000.
What about where is? How are the retirement offsets? First of all, what will they be? How many people are retiring? What is the offset? What's the figure for the offset? I know that in some districts they look at masters with a step five and they do the difference between what the retiree is making and that number, and then add them up, and that's an offset. Do we have that information? Will it be part of the budget to show how it might be used, either to decrease the bottom line or as a way to pay for the two IT people? Where does that fall in the whole budget thing?
Well, Kathy, I'll see if I can state it a little bit clearer than I stated it yesterday, because Kathy, we discussed this yesterday. But historically, since I've been here, we have budgeted our employees at their present composition carried forward 1 year. So what I'm saying by that is we've budgeted who we own on as of January 1st into the next fiscal year. There's no question a couple of those people are retiring, okay? So that's how we've done it historically. What that has resulted in, generally, has been a small surplus in salary for the reasons you just stated, okay? What's that generally been used for are things that we're not able to budget as of January 1st. Lane changes, for one example, is that our contracts, they don't have to have them until March. So we're not able to put them forward in the budget. It's usually 10, this year there's a few more. And then we use it for, you know, either if we need a new position in the next year, that type of thing. Generally, as you look at back quarterly reports, that reduces a surplus of somewhere between a half to 0.75%, generally, in that line item. Maybe a little bit more, maybe a little bit less. Last fiscal year, it generated a surplus of $15,000. So what I mean by that is, if we had done what we may be talking about doing, namely taking out the delta for retirees last year, our salary situation last year would have been a deficit by, say, $85,000. Generally, every other year that we've done it, we probably could do it. So we have, and Kurt, I don't know if you have the number off the top of your head, I have it, but we have 8 or 9 people retiring, I think.
Yep.
So, you know, if you took $100,000, I think it's relatively safe to do that off the retirees, but it's important to state we've never done it before, okay? And the only caution I would have, it's fine, okay, is that we're cutting everything to make this work pretty tight. Like, we cut the school choice numbers down, tuitions down, we cut, you know, all those things. So there's not gonna be much the health insurance, there's not gonna be much flexibility next year if something goes wrong. If nothing goes wrong.
Don't we have E&D for that?
We're using almost all our E&D. So
but George, when you say we're using almost all our E&D, if I don't understand that fully, then I think, oh my gosh, we have no more E&D, we have zero, we have nothing.
No, the answer is yes, we should have some, but I just don't know how much right now. I mean,
I know, but we do this every year, and then it's like, oh, we're not that bad by the time it refunds itself. So,
well, we were down $1 million.
I think Kathy's point is, what is the number, Kurt?
I have roughly. You wanted to take 40,000 for the lanes and chains?
Well, I don't want to, but that's what it is. Yes,
you're going to utilize. Yes. So you should have roughly about 170. Well,
170.
Is that over the master's five?
If you're taking a master's five, yeah.
I'm afraid I have more questions.
Well, finish this part of the discussion.
Yeah, I mean, that's, what's the visibility to that? In the budget.
Should we decide to do it?
We have to decide.
And my only question then at this point is, are we shoehorning? Are we shoehorning into positions that aren't necessarily planned for or wanted?
Are they needed?
Is that the IT?
Yeah.
I will say that.
Well, wait. I want to hear from Dr. Bates. I think we should hear from Dr. Bates.
Sure. Well,
Dr. Bates, can you give us your opinion quickly before someone says something?
I always look at is it a need or a want?
Is it a need or a want?
Laura Friend feels it's a need. It's a need to help her meet the needs of her students currently within the middle school model. You have, my understanding, correct me if I'm wrong, you have one gentleman who's running around to three different areas to try to...
819 students he has.
And when you instituted the one-on-one initiative with your eighth graders, it's been a little bit tight, let's say.
Mm-hmm. So this is a need.
And see, this is where I go back to in doing a needs assessment right at the beginning of a budget. And so you have this all laid out. Mm-hmm. And so when you're doing the budget process, you're prioritizing. And when you get to a situation like this, then you have to, you go through your priority.
Right. So we have a digital learning environment that's only growing and technology's not going away.
Right.
That sounds like a need.
But on the other hand, I also understand where the goal of schools are going when you look at your libraries and really looking at an integrated library media specialist who has dual certification and can make your libraries into like a learning common where you're having, you know, it's no longer just taking out books, it's utilizing all those strategies and skills and standards of integrating technology there. There's that piece of, there are districts now that are going, doing away with libraries and having a like I said, a technology media specialist integrating and running that environment.
So are you suggesting that, what are you suggesting?
Lorraine, if I might too, so there was also two elements to this, IT people that I need to insert here. So there's the technology committee that's been meeting in the district throughout,
right,
you know, this period. And that was a specific request by them in order to meet the expanding...
To have the IT people?
Right. It was not officially put in the budget when that was done prior to the end of the year or whatnot, but it had reached a point where if this objective is going to be completed, what is needed to get it done? And then we also looked at the district improvement goals. All four district improvement goals are very heavy, technologically focused, and asked, nothing was ever put together in the district improvement goals that related to budget, and it probably should have, because we need to be scalable with the plans, and we need to understand what the staffing needs are, and what the technology needs are, and we never defined that, or it's never been defined. So that is part of where those two IT, where they came from, for that request.
Okay. So we have $170,000, and you don't want us to use it all.
I see it.
No, I hear where you're at. You're conservative. That's why we're in. I mean, that's okay.
I think we can use probably at least 100 relatively comfortably in most circumstances.
And Lothar Burbank needs an IT person, because we've got one person running back and forth amongst the schools in our IT utilization and implements are only growing. What do you guys think? It's like the quiet part of the room.
What did you, yeah, inhale too.
Inhale. But you want, yeah, you want the IT person too.
Yeah, I mean, I think what Kurt said, I think it solves the same issue though. I think the IT,
right,
whatever. The
what you decide,
yeah,
to do,
right.
As long as the
same,
technology is taken,
yeah,
care,
exactly,
of.
Exactly.
Right, for the students. Yeah, I'm with you. What do you guys think? You gotta have an opinion.
I think we should budget for it if we have this money that we can move for that, but I think we should leave it open-ended enough so that they can decide how to formulate the solution for that need within that school.
Right, I think that's what Kurt was saying.
Right. I think you need to look at, again, I think the, I believe the principal should have a choice of what meets their need.
Oh, when we, I don't think, Kathy, are you dictating that it
no.
Would, no, I think it's give them.
But Neil is right, that we have been working on that. Neil, Lynn and myself have gone to the technology committee meetings,
mm-hmm.
and this is part of their technology plan, and it came through that the concern about the fact that the middle school technology teacher, instructional technology teacher, provides classes for all the kids and all the middle schools 2 days a week. And it used to be there was one at each school. So it's a restoration. It's not, in my mind, it's a restoration.
Because we took it away.
So they're trying to teach and they're trying to troubleshoot at the same time. So they have to tell a teacher, hang on, I'll get to you after my class, or what, you know what I mean, this type of thing. And that
so once
obviously
every
doesn't
days.
Work well.
All right, Lynn, what do you think?
Once every 3 days.
Huh?
They get them once every 3 days. They just rotate.
Oh. Okay. So do we want to add these two positions in? Utilizing
the offset.
The
so
offset
would you say
from
it was 170,
the Delta on the retirees.
And if you go with the
just take
100,
take
yeah, you still come out ahead. You come out if you hire at master's step 5 or below, there's still a difference.
Right. Well,
there's about
50,000 left.
Yeah.
You guys, what do you think? What do you think? Yes, no, up, down? We gotta make.
So, is the proposal for two full-time?
Two full-time IT media specialists at $61,000 a piece.
Right. I actually feel like I'm not ready to vote on it because I'm interested, but I would want to see the actual detailed budget, which we didn't get to see tonight, before I add anything more to it.
So okay, so
I'm interested is my point of view, I guess.
You're interested, but we need a little more than that because we're bumping up against the regional agreement. So,
sure.
And I hear you, and as soon as we give George a little more direction tonight, he can finalize that and get it out to us quickly so we can look at it. But we kind of have to start making some decisions about what we want to do in order for this budget to be ready for next Thursday. I'm not putting you on the spot.
Sure.
I think we're all kind of feeling like I wish I had another month, but we don't.
Well, I could put it in, and then if you, after you see it next Thursday, you can make a final decision.
Well, next Thursday is the day.
Right, but I mean, I could put it in the form and send it out, so, you know.
Better to put it in, and then we can start.
Yes,
it.
Yes, yes. But then I think the, what's the thought? So we put the two IT positions in, but what's
make
the,
sure there's an offset.
But
so
that's what
not
I was going to say. What's the thought?
Yeah,
no,
the
I understand. No,
offset, you'll take
yes,
it out of there.
Yeah,
okay.
No, yeah,
all right. Good.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'll just offset it to the cost of that, nothing else, though, right?
Sure.
So if it's an offset, it's not going to affect
we'll
the final
change
budget.
Those
budget.
Right.
Yeah.
And to that. So I'd like, if possible, I mean, we just talked about this today, I'm sorry, but Bill's here, and he has another appointment. So can we talk briefly about the proposal we have regarding the structure of the facilities office?
Sure. What are your...
Okay. As you know, last week we had a long discussion about the facilities reorganization. We ultimately decided, I guess you didn't vote, so I refused it. I just wanted to indicate it. Then what we're going to do is we're going to remove the custodial services manager and put in a full-time administrative assistant. Okay, and that was a savings of $50,000. Bill had made a presentation to the personnel subcommittee a week or two ago, but due to the timing of the meeting stuff, the committee wasn't able really to deliver and to make a recommendation to the full committee. Bill has some compelling reasons which he can speak to why he feels that's an important position. I understand the budget neutrality aspect of this. Okay, so what I would propose is, hear Bill's proposal, keep the custodial service manager in Y, and if he's able to do it, I have a proposal that we can make it budget neutral as, but I think it makes sense. So if that would be acceptable.
Well, how would it be budget neutral? What's the...
Because the cost would be essentially from where we are now, there would be a $25,000 cost, but one of the reasons that, and I want Bill to make the case, and he can make it more compellingly and better and more thoroughly than I can, but one of the things we struggle with and one of the things this person does that a full-time administrative assistant couldn't do is coordinate our building use, weekends, nights, things like that. So looking at our custodial services revolving fund, which is used for two things, it's used for some offset of our turf field debt, that's represented, that's for money people rent the turf field, goes into that fund. And it's also used, of course, to support anybody who rents, the money goes in there, and we pay custodial at the time or whatever our costs are out of that fund. Even covering those expenses, with an analysis in the fund for the last 3 years, the fund has increased on the average by about $30,000 a year. So where this position really supports in many ways that activity of the district, I would propose that we take an additional $25,000 a year from that fund to allow us to retain the custodial service manager and not the administrative assistant. Bill feels, again, I want Bill to speak to it, and he can more easily pick up the administrative assistant things within the office than he can the other things in the field. So Bill, is that we possibly, can we briefly address that?
You know what, wait a second, whoa. We're supposed to start the budget hearing at 7:15, he's got 4 minutes.
Okay. Thank you.
Come on up here, Bill.
Should I come up that way?
Now you got 3 minutes and 57 seconds.
I can be quick.
Okay.
I know it's easy to talk.
Just talk. So, you're good.
Thank you. So the custodial services manager, in talking with George, and where we could really get the biggest impact, and I understand there has to be cuts, and I understand it's, you know, there's some areas that we're going to have to bend on. When I looked at the services we provide and what the custodial services manager gives to the facilities district, to the facilities department, it really is the best bang for what we do here. The custodial services manager looks at the events. We currently run 7 days a week from about 7 a.m. till about 11 p.m. almost every single day. And these events need to be managed not only with the custodial operations, for coverage, for insurance, making sure setups are done. It's a very time-consuming job, and that's something that this role directly works with. Also, it's the pure custodial operations, the getting into the buildings, checking sanitation, making sure we have proper equipment, directly managing our staff. We have a high absentee rate and trying to coordinate who's going to be showing up, what day, when we can have overtime coverage. Some of the other tasks that we do that are spread out throughout the office, I think, can be distributed amongst myself as well as the custodial services manager. But I do look at that role as giving a big impact to the services we deliver every day in the facilities department, the after-school events, and the direct custodial operations of the classroom, which impacts staff, students, community. So I really do feel it's a critical role, and I hope you rethink it.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Nicole, I looked at you and said Lynn. Hi, Nicole.
I just do have a quick question.
Yes.
For clarification. Having done a lot of after-school events and weekend events, coordinating them with the... I have dealt with a custodial service manager once or twice, mm-hmm. but to be honest, the receptionist at the building knows everything and coordinates everything for us. She is indispensable. I don't know if she coordinates on my end. I'm sure there's stuff
yes.
going on in the back end, but it seems to me that I couldn't imagine the building running without her.
And I absolutely
yeah.
agree with you. In the front office there, that is a critical role, but that role only is there from 7 o'clock in the morning to 3:30 in the afternoon, Monday through Friday. Most of our events start at 3:30.
So he goes to those events?
He's in and out, or at least, I'll tell you, you find the custodial services manager at most of the buildings throughout the weekends, managing the events, checking in, at least on call 24/7, making sure
to
take care of
any problems. Are there no custodians in the building after 3:30? Is that typical?
We do have custodians in the building,
oh,
yes.
You have to have a custodian to have an event, period, right? I thought that was a rule.
For the most part, yes. Sometimes we allow events with Neshoba staff.
Uh-huh.
Being available because just the custodial overtime to cover some, take away the ability to run
but
these
shouldn't
events.
Shouldn't the cost of renting the building or using the building include the cost of whatever custodial services people need?
Well, that's a whole other conversation.
Yes.
I mean, it's a good one, but not for now, but yes.
Excellent.
Like we get, what, $50 to rent the auditorium in the high school?
$25.
$25.
Thank you.
We're going to revisit that later after the budget's
I would really like to be part of that.
We can all talk about that.
Thank you.
But at any rate, right now on the table, what we're talking about is this position, Bill. Thank you. Does anybody else have questions for Bill?
So who fields the initial call when somebody's going to be renting? Is it the administrative assistant that does this?
Right now, the administrative assistant would take the initial call, and then the custodial services manager begins the coordination efforts, and that's whether we have the availability, the coordinator through the school principals and the secretarial staff, whether they have insurance.
Isn't it all online? Like when I do it online.
It is, and once it comes in online, that's where it gets, he picks it up from there and makes sure that we have flags that can be raised as, is insurance paid, are past invoices paid, what the event actually needs for setup, what we're gonna need for custodial staff, whether we're gonna need fire or police details on the staff, and then coordinating the entire event with the big picture of what other events are going on in the building, what staff want to work overtime, who can work overtime.
So, Bill, I'm sorry, but so if we flip this with your proposal, who's going to be in the front office, and how does that impact the teachers, the administration, the students by not having the administrative assistant there versus bringing someone in?
This should be...
If she's gone, who's filling her place?
That would have to be split between the custodial services manager and myself. Fielding those emails and any of those calls that initially come in.
Are you thinking the administrative assistant in the front office, like at the high school or here?
No, I'm asking in this, so if she's, if the administrative assistant is fielding the initial contacts, the calls that are coming in and so forth, and he was mentioning the front office, and I don't know how this situation
are you talking about your administrative
my administrative assistant who's a 20-hour a week position
who gets
right
the phone
now.
Call
you're talking about okay
yeah, yes. I thought you were
talking about
school.
The front office
yes,
yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry
and
no
this was okay.
No this is in my facilities department currently okay. We have an administrative assistant who works at 20 hours and the custodial services
okay.
Manager
all right
quick question if it's almost all the time that we're doing this and it's 24/7 I mean 20 like 8 to 11 or whatever mm-hmm. Why would we do overtime for that why wouldn't we hire shifts. Wouldn't that be a lot less expensive if it's if what you're saying is true, it's every day, and maybe we'll have down days. We could have them do other cleaning activities or something. But you know what I mean? Wouldn't that be a cost?
We do have shifts that cover from 7 in the morning to 11 at night plus our weekends.
I thought you said we had to schedule overtime.
We do. Some events, like this weekend, we have DI, which are expecting close to 1,000 people to show up. We have basketball and we have a soccer tournament going on at the same time. I have weekend staff that work.
But you need additional for this week.
Right, but in order to be lean and look at absolute critical needs, we have our staff set a very basic coverage. And then we look at any additional coverage through overtime. Because to cover for DI this weekend and for the soccer event, I've got 3 or 4 additional staff members throughout Saturday and Sunday. And this is a blip on the radar, but it's a very resource-heavy blip on the radar this weekend. And as spring comes, all the sporting events start coming in, and I know.
Thanks. All right, we need to kind of wrap this up.
Just to summarize,
yeah.
This position, custodial services manager position, was added in 2014. The salary for this position is currently $74,000. This position was added at a time when we had eliminated the 2 IT teachers at the middle schools and the 2 library media specialists at the middle school. So the proposal that we agreed to, I think last week, was that currently there is a part-time department assistant. The request was a full-time department assistant, but I think that we wanted to know what the department assistant currently does and what additional responsibilities that person would have if it went to full time. I think it's an expensive position. I would like to see what the facilities department can do. I'm adverse to spending that kind of money when there are still positions of direct services to kids that need to be restored. And that's just my opinion.
All right. You can sit down. You don't have to stand there. Thank you.
Thank you
so much. I need to hear from the rest of you about this.
Well, Dale, I have the answer to my question from last week, which was, what are the things that he's losing when we take away that position? And we now have some understanding of what that is.
And what do you think we're losing?
I think it's having good control over our facilities and also good management of our custodians. We have a building and facilities manager that may end up spending his time attending to rentals rather than perhaps his primary task, which is dealing with the buildings and the future of our buildings and maintenance. So I'm hearing that there's some desirable to have administrative support so that...
How much administrative support do we have in the whole facilities department? just give me the FTEs and functionally where they are.
We have a 0.5 administrative assistant and the 1.0 services manager.
And then the structure within the schools is?
I'm sorry, there's a custodian, there are two in each school, is that what you mean?
Is there a manager of
custodians? No, there's a senior custodian in each town.
And what did, and a senior custodian in each town. Why can't the senior custodian in each town do the management that this function is currently doing? Should I ask Bill that?
Yes, but I don't.
He left.
I'd rather have him get him back here. You can talk about something else because I think that's an important question that I'd rather have.
Well, I guess that's my question is, why do you have someone who's managing two buildings in each town?
And it seems like this particular position is there solely to coordinate when our rentals are...
And administrative.
No, it's not at all. That's why I think that I'd rather have him come back. I don't know where he went.
So this was new in 2014?
Yes,
yeah.
It was.
Can you
come
back in?
Yep. Can I ask a question?
Thank you. You'll be right back. But the person does a lot of other things all day long. They manage all our custodial services. That's his main job. But he plays an additional role. And I'll let Bill speak to this. He plays an additional role in his other areas of management, etc. And like I say, we made the original proposal. Bill's been very concerned about it. I agree with what Mark said. I'm concerned about the impact it'll have on Bill. And if we can do it even for another year to try it out, cost neutral, giving up the administrative assistant, I would like to.
But we were talking about doing the opposite, right? Adding more administrative assistants.
Right.
Most of it sounded like administrative work,
right.
And this position was a very expensive
right.
position.
We were talking about that. Yes,
okay.
That's correct. So we're flipping it around. The cost of the flip is $25,000. And understanding the budget pressures, that's why I suggested, and I did the math today, and I can show it to you if you'd like, on the revolving fund. So Bill should be right back here to be able to answer the question regarding the senior custodians better than I can.
All right, so we don't have to wait for Bill, but
so
Neil, you have something?
Last week your suggestion, I believe, was to eliminate that position and to increase the administrative assistant, which is what I think Kathy was saying. So I'm just going to ask you what in your mind has changed that you're deciding that this needs to be done opposite.
Well, as I say, I tried to clarify last week, and I understand it's confusing. I wasn't necessarily saying I thought it was the best idea. I was saying I thought we could operate that way. And what has changed my mind is my discussions with Bill, and that's why I've asked him to present to you. Bill, there's a question you have.
I'm sorry.
Now we got to go back. I got to unwind. The custodial manager in each town, is that right?
Just one custodial services manager is district-based.
No, what's
senior custodian? Senior custodian.
Head custodian. Thank
head custodian. We've got a lot of layers here. So we have a head custodian that oversees both buildings. Like, do I have, in Bolton, do I have?
There's two head custodians in Bolton. One for here.
And one at the high school.
And one at the high school.
So correct. I've got this... Between you and this position and what are we calling this? Head custodian manager, I don't know. Head custodian manager, supervisor.
Yes.
Okay, head custodian. No.
Custodial services.
Whatever. We've got this role, and then we've got a head custodian for each.
For each building, correct.
Building, and then we've got custodians.
Then we have custodians.
It's quite a structure. I have a hard time with the proposal. I was going to put it out there. That's just my opinion. I think there's a lot of layers, and I understand.
And the head custodian, again, isn't any type of management or supervisory role. It's a $2.50 a month on the salary, and they usually act as our lead custodian in the building.
I think it was Thursday.
So, yeah, that Kathy had a good comment, and it's not for you, but George, you want to address it?
The principal should be supervising the custodians, and I speak from experience.
Can you just address that as to how our system works and stuff? I mean, he can address it better than I can. That's what he'll do, right?
Sure. I mean, somebody's got to answer it, yeah.
So, Carly, in order to manage a custodial staff, one of the things that the custodial services manager spends a lot of time on, probably half the time of their week, is actually coordinating when people are here, who's covering shifts. There's, again, absentee rates. So that's what they're working. They're also going through the building. He's here usually in the morning at times, 6 o'clock in the morning, inspecting rooms and going through, making sure inventory is taken care of and ordering is done properly. So.
All right. Thank you, Bill. Appreciate that.
I have a question.
Yep.
In your view, what are the tasks that you would find fall upon you if this position departs? And what, in your view, what are the things that make it more difficult for you to accomplish things by having this position disappear?
In this case, it would be the coordinating custodial operations right down to the granular level, which would be scheduling times, scheduling overtimes, covering absences, coordinating coverage when we have snow events, also making sure that we have inventory ordered, that we are following, that, you know, we look at technology and custodial technology as far as we're using proper chemicals.
But now we're getting into a whole job description. I think those are all the things that would have to be covered on you. You would have to cover them?
Yes, and event management for what we do.
Aren't we increasing the administrative assistant role?
Yeah.
Yes.
So this is.
So wouldn't that person start to do some of those things?
The scheduling and.
Some of those things that person could take, but the administrative assistant role wouldn't be available on the weekends. It wouldn't be one of those coverage that would be coordinating events, as well as looking at covering when we have absentees and trying to call staff in.
Okay.
So there's a little bit of, there would be some overlap there.
All right. Thank you, Bill. I think we need to start wrapping up this conversation. You have a comment,
yeah,
and then we got to let Bill go. Go ahead. Let him leave.
I'm a little confused. You said that the fund that you have for the custodian fund, this comes from the custodian revolving fund.
Yeah.
It's taking care of the field debt, and all the money comes in, and it's supposed to take care of the field?
No, that's not what I said. I said it has two purposes that we generally use it for. One is it provides part of the offset for the field debt, because when people rent the field, their money goes to that fund, so therefore that's where we use that fund. Okay, so it covers that. It additionally covers expenses related to rentals of facilities. In other words, if we hire overtime for custodian and stuff like that, we generally try to pay it from that fund, obviously, as opposed to paying it from the budget. You know what I mean? So that's what it's used for. But because of, you know, what the charges for rentals are, even though I think they can be enhanced and we can actually make more money than we make on it, I think that's a discussion we do need to have. I'm saying, if you look at the last 3 years, it's averaged about $28,000 to $29,000 a year after paying expenses growth. So what I'm suggesting is, for no additional cost to the budget, we can let Bill keep the other person, and I think it's a legitimate use of that money, because so much of that job has to do with building use, so therefore it's being used as required. We can't use it for a math teacher, is what I'm trying to say. It's not legal to use it for a math teacher. It's legal to use it for a position like this, so that's why I would.
Well, there must be other applications for it.
We can't use it for math teacher, but we can use it to buy all those pellets to go underneath the rug. I mean, why is that a separate item in the budget? I mean, I thought that this trap was going to be self-sustaining, and yet every year we're putting money out to support it.
And it's truly not budget neutral if we have $28,000 and then we use that $28,000 on something. So
the $28,000 isn't going away from the bottom line that we have from Michelle. We're just trying to explain what I think the best use of the money is and the best practice and the best for the district. It's certainly up to the committee's decision and with respect to that.
I'm just trying to get an idea, because that 28 that you're saying is revenue neutral is 28 that we'd be taking from a fund and using that to subsidize that
position, basically, is what we'd say. So we'd have $28,000 less.
It's coming in. If I wasn't clear, I meant budget neutral. The bottom line of the budget I showed tonight, much like the vote we just had a few minutes ago, decision we had a few minutes ago on the IT. That's the analogy.
Thank you.
Okay. Guys, we need to move on. So I need some understanding for George. George needs some understanding as to where we want to move with this. Do you want to maintain the original proposal of the reorg and consolidate the position of the custodial services manager and the part-time department assistant into a full-time administrative assistant position, or do you want to leave the position as it currently stands with the custodial services manager as a full FTE and then the part-time administrative assistant? Right? Did I get that right?
Sounds right to me.
Do you want to vote? Do you want a motion?
I don't know that we have to vote. I think we can do it by consensus and agreement, and then you'll put it in the budget like we did last week, right?
Did you say yes?
We wouldn't be leaving a part-time. We'd be eliminating the part-time position if the assistant manager stays.
Right.
Oh, so this is even different from the original.
We'd be increasing it.
It's a flip from last week. Right. So all we're doing here is flipping. Right now, after last week, we have a full-time administrative assistant.
Right.
Okay? If we flip this, we'll have a full-time custodial manager and no administrative assistant.
Oh, I don't like that.
Right. So then there's no administrative. Right.
Okay.
No,
what do you guys think?
I'm concerned. I'd like to know more about that revolving account. As Lynn was saying, if it's used to maintain fields and do other things, I'd like to see how that money's been expended. And we're also going to get feedback from MASBO about our revolving funds.
Okay, but how about this proposal?
I felt we made a decision last week. I didn't agree with it. I'd like to see the whole $74,000 cut. But I think the consensus of the group was to go with the reorganization of the facilities office and reduce it by $50,000.
Lynn?
I agree with
Kathy. Nicole?
I agree with Kathy.
Neil?
I would have to agree based on our conversation. This is kind of changing things.
That's a yes. That's a one word, right? Yeah, yes. Kia?
I agree.
Mark?
Can I ask Bill a question?
Yes.
In terms of losing the administrative assistant, what are the activities, how will they be spread elsewhere or accommodated by staff?
Well, by the part-time administrative assistant we have currently?
If you lose that position.
That would be purchase requisitions, purchase orders, some insurance documentation, filing general clerical duties would have to be absorbed back to me and the second member of my staff.
Okay, thank you. So I'm would be favorable to having the custodial services person would be full time.
Okay.
And no administrative assistant.
And no administrative assistant.
Yes.
Okay. And I'm not, I can't go there. I'm so sorry. I know you don't want to do this, but I see the role as so much administration, so much administrative assistant administration, and because it's relatively new, I have to agree that we would keep it. With the new proposal, the first proposal, which is to consolidate the position. But I also want that $25,000 you found.
It's not a fine. You can have it anytime you want.
That's awesome. So offset it, and like she said, on the rug. And
Lorraine,
then
it's in the revolving fund, and we haven't really had a good and proper and comprehensive conversation about revolving funds.
Is it available to be used to offset something else in the budget if we could use it to offset this particular proposal?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Let's let it sit there. Let's use it.
It's a choice the school committee could make, but also it's desirable for the school committee to have a comprehensive understanding of this area, which we've not yet.
Totally get that, Mark. And when we get to that point where we have time to actually do that, we all have said we want to know.
Right.
But if you've identified $25,000 that you could use for this, now, you could use it for that now.
Right, but I just want to clarify, there's $100,000 in the fund. The reason I identified $25,000 is that's reflective of the average growth of the fund for the last 3 years after expenses, okay? So you could use 180,000 if you want. But
so,
but I don't think you want to.
Why do we accrue so much money in these accounts?
Why do we need that in there?
I don't know. It's
we can't. That's philosophical. We're not doing that. Stay on task.
We haven't really accrued it much into the last couple few years. That's what I'm saying. It's doubled in the last few years.
Still a lot of money.
Yeah, it is.
What do you want to do about that, Neil?
Yeah,
thank you.
So, I'm looking for this, George, desperately.
Yeah.
But we have budget in here a considerable amount of money that we're going to be spending on maintaining the turf field.
Yep.
And I just see that. I mean, I think in my mind, I'm thinking 16 for something and 34 for another, like for a combination of $50,000, which is substantial. And when we first took the field on, it was going to be a revenue generator, not even revenue neutral or a loss. And I'm just seeing that if we're budgeting for these things and we can take money from that, we can start paying for some of the turf field, and we're making it work that way.
I'm not objecting.
Do you know what I mean? I'm kind of throwing this out at you. I'm not like,
we can use the $25,000 if you'd like. Absolutely.
Well, it's in the budget, and we can use it as an offset.
No, right. I'm saying we can use it. Right.
Why don't
we can use it as an offset? Yes, we can.
So let's just do it.
Okay. If there are places, but are there other places in the budget?
Well, you can look at. I don't have my budget book because I gave it to MASPO, so.
You know what?
Could you take another look, George?
Yeah, we
the
can,
things
you can
that
look
we can
right
offset
now.
From revolving
we
cuts.
Right
I don't
now.
Think Lorraine wants us to look right now.
I don't know that we can. We have got. We are so behind. Guys, this is work we should have done up until this point. So if there's no, what I'm saying is, if there are places we want to look, give it to George. We've got to move forward. Are there any other areas in the budget?
I kind of have one.
What is it? It's okay.
We were given a list of class sizes at the high school, and we have a list of classes with less than 10. But and there's one particular course that has, where the teacher's class load is about 44. And we raised the issue at personnel with Dr. Graham. I know we're under the gun, but I think we need to exercise some due diligence in seeing if that's an area where we might have a cut that could be used to offset something else, another staffing need. So I don't know how that works in the scheme of this, but it's another example of something that we didn't.
I think we need to get Dr. Bates' input on it, and I don't want to put you on the spot. So if
and
you
then
wanna...
I have one last thing. Oh, do you want to?
Yeah, well, can we do one?
Okay.
Just been.
Oh, you don't.
No one's saying.
Okay.
No. Do you want? What do you want, Harry?
Yes, it's about the what's the class? It's not it.
It's theater arts.
It's theater arts. And I think that there was a FTE. I don't know if it was 0.2 or 0.4 added that in hopes of growing the program. Mm-hmm. It hasn't grown, so it may be an area to look at. Then the last thing, and it's nothing we can do today, but I want
good.
I have a list called After Budget. I really want us to look at the step differentials. This was the way it was when I left in 2003. It could have been solved by now, by me, but other districts have a uniform percentage increase for steps and columns. And I know that's a serious conversation.
Mm-hmm.
Because
it's good timing after the budget,
yes.
Because this is the year
yes.
that we're going to start talking
but
about negotiations for the contracts.
This surprises me.
Well, there
and
you have it. So
at
least now we know. Okay. Does anybody else have anything they want to talk about, Lynn?
No, I'm sorry.
Well, no, this is the time to do it. I mean, we've got... Okay, you don't want to talk about it. Oh, Nicole. Neil.
I do, if somebody looks at the budget book and they see some of the specific items where we're dealing with the roll-in.
With
the what?
The roll-in and the percentages. So the auto allowance roll-in. And
mm-hmm.
I think that we need to make sure that that is very clear. Because there was a roll-in for mileage or car allowances that were allowed.
Non-union salaries.
Right. So that was rolled into salaries. And then we agreed that that was not those people should not be penalized. That wasn't their decision to do it. And so we voted on a 2% increase for those people. But that is going to, even though total compensation is increasing by 2%, it is going to be reflective of the salary increase of, for some people, what, 6, 7% or something? And we need to be, so we need to be very clear in our message to everyone that total compensation hasn't changed, and explain that, because it doesn't look too responsible on our end just to look at the percentage increase. And I don't see it actually reflected in this, so I just want to make sure that when that comes out, that we either have some narrative that reflects that in the budget book, or that when we go on the town meeting roadshow, that it is reflective in that.
So I'll let George and Dr. Bates decide how they're going to put that reference in there.
I think with non-union positions, that you put a recommended amount in, it's 2%, but typically that gets decided on a case-by-case. So it's not a blanket increase.
Well, it has been, though.
It has been, but I'm just saying it doesn't have to be. It could be case-by-case. And if you look at the way the vehicle allowances impacted salary increases for some people last year, you'll see that there's a huge range and way above 2%.
So again, we talked about this a little bit last week. Do you want to do anything about that, or do you want to leave it alone?
This is going to piggyback back off of this to add to this question. So there is $20,000 that has been added to the budget for in-state, in-district driving, I think it is, reimbursement. So the question, if you follow this, hopefully not down the wormhole, but if we rolled, it originally was $32,000. Mm-hmm. If we rolled that complete $32,000 into salaries, in theory, there should be no mileage allowance. Otherwise, what we've just done is we've increased the mileage allowance by the 32 that we rolled in there, and an additional 20% ask for that particular line item. And I either would like to get some rationale on that or eliminate that.
We didn't roll $32,000 into salaries.
It came out to $28,000 or $29,000 total, I think, with the
22.
Was it 22?
I can check that.
I'm going off the top of my head, so.
I think it was 22.
I'm sorry about that. Someone's at my front door.
So what's your question to George, so we can?
So the question is, it seems it to me seems like there is an addition to that monies. So we've rolled in, if you add in the amount that was rolled in plus the ask, that's an increase. And I'm just, is there somebody that's newly eligible for this? Is there, I mean, where's that increase coming from, I guess, the justification?
I don't know the answer off my head.
All right, well,
I can find out, but I just don't know, because my record.
Yeah.
Some people are paid per mile still, okay?
Mm-hmm.
And will be, so. Mm-hmm.
Per mile?
They're putting
per
mile
reimbursement.
Reimbursed per mile.
Yeah.
Am I making sense with this?
I know exactly what you're
so
saying.
So if you add it, we didn't allot. Did we allot in a different line item for the per diem? So,
the per diem, I'm sorry.
Per mile that we're working on that. I think, if I'm not mistaken, Kathy, you have the amounts that were rolled in total?
I do. The total amount of vehicle allowances, the total came to $22,200. And then the range of increases were between 2.83 and 5.18. We were also told that because of that, first of all, the school committee didn't approve of that, but water under the bridge. However, we were told that people would not be putting in for mileage, and my understanding is that practice continued.
But wait a minute, let's not do that.
No, I'm just
I'm the numbers though.
But so last year, the total amount of vehicle allowances that people were eligible for and that got rolled into their salaries, the total amount is $22,200. Mm-hmm. So you're saying that
there's an additional $20,000 for a line item, which brings it to a total of $42,000 in present day money.
And you're saying that if $20,000 should not be in the budget.
Well, there's an additional, even if we kept it static and said, okay, well, we rolled in 20, it was, I think, 32, we roll in 22, that means there's 10 that's still out there for people that we're getting reimbursed, theoretically, if I'm following that correctly. We've increased that yet another 10 for reimbursement.
Okay, what are we doing here, guys?
I'll look at it this week. I'll look at it. I'm trying to look at it now.
What do you want to propose?
Yes. What I'm proposing is that we establish what that additional monies is going for, because it's doubled.
It has doubled
for if we're reimbursing people that were getting mileage. We had 10,000 left over. Follow me. 32,000.
No, I have 10,000.
But now we're asking for 20. So that's a $10,000 or a double the amount for the people that are getting reimbursed. And I'm just asking for a narrative to that.
No, I understand your question about 10,000, right? It's not double, it's 10,000. We had 32,000 before, and now we have 42,000 in your money.
Right, no, not the total. That 10,000. So I'm assuming that 10,000 for people to get reimbursed.
The line item for DM was 10,000. You expected it to be around 10,000 again.
That's right.
That would have made sense to you.
That's right.
And it's not 10,000 again, it's 20,000.
Right.
So the narrative is asking for, should it be moved back down to 12, maybe, for a small increase?
That's exactly right. Thank you.
So you're asking it to be 12, is what you're asking, period, or
explain why. Right.
So why don't you ask for it to be set at 12, and then if we need it for 20, come to the next meeting with why, and we can bump it up.
I'm fine to do that. But
okay,
that
was good.
That's what you're trying to say.
Well, not exactly, but yes.
It's $12,000. It's $8,000. What do we want to do? Do you want to propose knocking that down to 10 or 12? See what I'm saying? Like, we can make this decision, and we can move.
Yeah, I understand.
What do you want?
Multi-million-dollar budget. We're talking about $10,000 here.
But it's also the principal.
But it's 10, it's
I know, but let's get
there, and that's maybe a part-time administrative.
So what do you want to propose? I'm open. Just throw it out.
So $10,000 instead of $20,000, unless, you know, come back, and then there's something else, and then modify that. But that's what I'm proposing.
George, what's the downside?
No, we can do it.
Okay, you can do it. Kathy, you good with that?
Sure.
Mark?
Is this money being paid for the administrative staff, as best you understand for that line item?
I'm hesitant to guess.
I have no point of view on it.
Okay.
My question is, if who gets the reimbursement? If vehicle allowances were rolled in to the salaries of people who are eligible to get travel reimbursement,
are we still talking about the current?
I don't know what that budget thing is. I just want
to
know.
Okay.
So
I think other people did.
There's additional
other people
right.
did.
Okay,
well,
that's a point of clarification.
Right.
That's helpful.
To get a travel
right.
Or if somebody's going somewhere.
There are still some contracts where they can put in for mileage.
But not,
not a,
these
it's not
but it's not
right.
a
right.
All right,
yeah,
but that's right. helpful to know.
Right.
So do you want to reduce this fund
yes.
to $10,000? Lynn, do you want to reduce this fund to $10,000? It's $20,000 now. We only used $10,000 last year, and Neil's proposing $10,000, and you.
I'm with Mark. I don't have an opinion.
Okay. Just, I think the majority of people want to reduce it to $10,000. So if you would please add that. That would be great.
So we're actually reducing the budget just thrown out, because this is where I would say that I want facilities and all the stuff that had to do with the turf field, I want it removed and used for the rollover. Is that what we're doing right now?
You want to reduce the turf field?
In the budget for the facilities.
Yes.
When he did the breakdown.
Yes.
He had line items for the turf field.
Yes.
You want that to
I
come
want
out
that
of
to go in. Yeah, I want that to come out of the
revolving fund.
Revolving fund, correct.
Right.
Is this what we're doing right now? This is where I say this.
George, can we do that?
Anything you'd like. I suggested before we use the $25,000, which I have in my list of things to do. If you want to increase it to 50, you can, but you'll be cutting into the fund a little bit. But
turf maintenance right now is requesting 40.
Say it.
I believe if we're bringing 25 or 30 in a year and adding to it, we should take what we're bringing in, not cut into what's there for unforeseen use for the field, right?
Mm-hmm.
Big tears, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But use what we're taking in and subsidize the cost for the annual cost for turf maintenance,
yep.
et cetera.
Yep. That's a good idea.
And that's this particular one of pellets isn't yearly. It's a
it's
like every 5 years.
Every few years. And
yeah.
I said it was 60,000 to 40,000.
So you want to offset the 40 with 40 from the revolving fund? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, because then
that's
we still
idea.
Have we still have a surplus that we can
mm-hmm.
look at for emergencies. Does it?
Do you want to make a proposal, or do you want to ask George what the implications are?
What are the implications, George? George, are there implications for this?
The implications are everything. But I said, I think we can take $25,000 a year from the fund. I recommended we do it for maintaining the custodial service manager. That was rejected. If we'd like to do it for the purposes of offsetting the cost of the turf field, it's an allowable use for those funds.
Well, why wouldn't we do the whole thing if there's over, how much did you say was in that fund? The custodial services?
Top of my head, it's in the book, $180,000.
So why wouldn't we offset the whole 40?
Because you be, all I'm saying, you can certainly do that. I said you can do
so
that. I identify.
Around, so let me just, can I?
Yeah, because I don't
know. Philosophies around revolving funds is you take a number and you choose that's what you want to keep in it.
Yep.
Okay? So every year you want to maintain one number.
Okay.
Okay? So if we have an increase of 25, we feel, we don't go and dip into that
oh,
fund that
okay,
we decided to maintain. We
thank
only
you.
Take the increase.
Sure.
So we have a lot of revolving funds.
Yep.
We have them set at a level.
Yep.
There should be a discussion at some point, is that level appropriate?
Yep.
And that's what Mark was referring
mm-hmm.
to.
Mm-hmm.
But this year we feel that the 25 probably could be
okay.
taken.
And I would just add to that, if the level is
thanks,
deemed to be
yeah.
inappropriate and you'd like to spend the money, I think when you're spending down, you're better off spending on a lump sum one time
mm-hmm.
purchase.
Yes,
whereas
exactly.
when you're adding to an annual budget, you should probably stay with the annual.
Okay.
And that is a philosophy of revolving funds that should always be adhered to.
Well, that's good. Well, we actually we yeah.
Okay. So what are we doing again? Because we're gonna wrap this up so we can these poor people sitting here waiting. Are we taking 25? What are we doing?
I would make a motion to take the $25,000 of.
We don't have to.
Well, we don't have to.
No, we're giving. We're just consensus.
Can we just review so I make sure we all need. I don't have any. Misunderstandings. I'm putting the two $61,000 positions into the middle
mm-hmm.
schools, offsetting them with the retirement money.
Yep.
I'm going to take $8,000 from the travel line item.
Ten. It's 20 right now, so it'll be $10,000.
And I'm
going
12,
to
take
so
$25,000 of offset
from
custodial revolving.
Yep, that's what I have. Good. Everybody
yeah.
good. Right.
George,
moving on.
But I think George was going to come back on that $20,000
yeah,
and
I'm
say,
not,
okay, is there some other?
Yeah, I'm not okay with everything until I hear from George on that.
Right. Well, no, we're just
okay.
saying, George, this is where we think we want to go. This is what he's going to come back with.
All right.
It's going to be reflected in the numbers. Okay.
Yep.
And then we don't vote on this tonight.
Got
anyway.
It.
Okay. Any last? Mark, do you have anything? No. Kathy? No. Neil? No. I'm scared. Lynn? Are you sure?
Yeah.
Okay. Kathy?
Done.
We're all done. Okay. We're moving on. Correspondence. We're so late. Well, every piece of correspondence we got has been noted in the packet. The folks who sent us the piece of correspondence. We got emails in support of Dr. Bates' proposal. We got emails asking a lot of questions about it. Thank you for clarifying that tonight. And we got a couple of emails of concern. And so all of that's in the packet. And at this point, I need my cheat sheet. We do not have to adjourn from this meeting. We can just move right into the presentation of the FY17 budget. So now we're moving into the budget hearing, the annual budget hearing, and the budget hearing is a time when you actually can interact with us and ask questions. And how many people have been here, stuck here since the beginning of this meeting? How many people haven't been? You haven't been?
I didn't get here until 6:40.
All right, so did you see George take us through the budget discussion?
The slide thing, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So we probably, unless everybody would like us to, go through that presentation again. Does anyone need us to go through the presentation again? Nope. Okay, then I'm going to open it up to questions. So this is our, now that we've concluded the school committee business portion of the meeting, we are going to move into the budget hearing, where we're going to share our FY17 budget with you. This is an opportunity for the community to comment, to question. We want to hear your questions. We need to take your questions and your comments, and we need to consider those. As we start to wind down for next week, we'll hear from George if he has any, if you have specific questions. Anybody have any questions for George? Ma'am, could you tell us your name and your town?
Shauna Proteau from Bolton. And the only question that I would have for Bill that was here that I didn't hear anybody ask, if the head custodian position is eliminated in favor of an administrative position, I was curious how that would affect cleanliness in the schools. So I wasn't sure how it would affect functionally down the road. So that was a question that I had for that decision.
So how would...
I can't answer for Bill. I mean, we obviously strive to keep the schools as clean as we possibly can.
I just didn't know how much of that position interacting with the custodians and stuff would take away, possibly or not, custodial work.
The supervisory role with the custodians. That person,
supervisory
that person role. Supervises the custodian's work. He doesn't do the work. He supervises the work.
So ergo, it's not going to impact positively or negatively the cleanliness of the schools.
I don't know that because, you know, people aren't as regularly supervised. Sometimes they, I don't know. I
mean, but you do have somebody in each town, right?
That's correct. Yeah, we do.
Yeah,
okay.
And the building principal.
So I'm so I would say that if, I mean, I don't want to get back into that, but to your question.
That would just be the.
We still have custodians and we would still have a head custodian over
each
school.
That's what Bell seemed to say, exactly.
So, Mr. Burke?
No, I'm just
getting ready to run.
Well, I have to pick up a child, but you don't have a question for me, do you?
No, I thought you might have a question for us.
No, that's not why I stood up. I'm just heading out the door, but I want to commend the school committee on the diligence and the efforts there. Making to, and of course the administration as well, to look at all aspects of the budget in a way that in many respects is superior to the process that was undertaken when I was on school committee.
Oh, well, thank you very much. We appreciate that. Really, really appreciate that. Town Administrator Lowe, questions? Not to put you on the spot, if you don't have any, it's okay.
Well, first of all, I'd like to echo what Brian Burke said. I think the level of scrutiny that this budget is getting is impressive. You know, sometimes you don't like to see how the sausages are made, but still, that being said, I think it makes for a better budget process. I guess I have one question that didn't come up during the facilities discussion. Since that position was created in 2014, how was the need met prior to 2014?
Don't know.
That's a good question.
The person who eventually became the custodial service manager worked as a custodian, was paid additional stipend for the purpose of doing that type, most of that work.
Oh, thank you. Any other questions? Mr. Troop?
I don't really have any.
Yet.
Just listening tonight.
Okay. All right.
Maureen?
Maureen?
See if I can remember them all. I had questions about the department chairs as opposed to department heads. So the proposal is that they would be reduced another class section, correct?
Yes.
In order to take on the additional responsibility. So is budget-wise net effect, does that mean that they would just be paid the same salary that they've been paid, or will they be bumped up because they'll have additional responsibilities. Are these things that they can actually, how does this work with the teacher's contract? Because right now they're Unit A.
Exactly.
And that's kind of an administration thing, like an assistant principal or something would do. So, you know, is this, have you had that discussion about how you're going to bridge that?
So I'm going to turn it over to Kathy to answer that. We've in personnel, we've talked about it. We're looking at job descriptions, talking about opening up the contract. So go ahead, Kath.
Well, the NEAS recommendation, one of their recommendations was to create more of a leadership team with the principal and increase that level of instructional leadership at the high school by elevating the role of the department chair. So Dr. Graham has met with the personnel committee probably three, maybe four times to outline and refine his plan. So it would not be just a rollover of the people that are currently there. There would be an application process, and they would, some of the details, specific details, have not been worked out. The only two departments that would require backfill by the department chair only teaching three instead of four classes are math, and that would increase by 0.4, and science, which would increase by 0.2. All the other departments, the core departments, so that's math, English, social studies, foreign language, and science, the other departments other than math and science, the class loads could be distributed among the existing personnel. The questions that we're still working on have to do with the related arts, so you could combine fine and performing arts into one department chair. Business and technology could be one. We are still having discussions about what we would do with wellness, and we floated the idea that perhaps the athletic director who doesn't have a teaching load.
Thank you.
Okay,
I'm sorry.
But we haven't gotten into the nitty-gritty. In many districts, they have a department head model where the chairs are still in Unit A and contribute to the evaluations by doing observations and other contributions to the evaluation. I think as Dr. Bates and George have indicated at the personnel committee, the position itself would have to be impact bargain, but what I think it would be prudent for us to do is look at those districts that have department chairs that are in Unit A and some that might be in Unit B and see how they handle it. If anyone who has to do supervision and evaluation would have to be trained as such, and there are several wonderful organizations that provide that training. And so we're just working at the details at this point, but we've identified the main costs at this point. As an school committee administrator, did you want me to be quiet? You said I could.
No, do you understand even the answer? Are you done with the answer? Did you understand?
Yeah.
Okay. Do you need more?
So you don't actually know for certain that there's no additional budget impact.
Well, there has to be impact bargain.
But right. Okay. So what you don't know what that will be yet.
From school committee / management point of view, the reduction of one class, and because they already get a stipend for being a department head. So the reduction of one teaching period, reduction of perhaps 20 to 25 kids, would be, we see that as compensation on offset. However, it still has to be impact bargain. So we don't know.
Okay.
But that's what we're thinking.
Okay.
You had another question.
You don't have the detailed budget like we've had in past years yet, do you?
We have it.
I know. It's not available online at this time. Am I correct, or have I just missed
It's not, and as soon as George makes his edits, it will be online, because we have been pulling it apart, and there would be 20 different versions of it. But as soon as George makes his edits, it's going to be online, right?
I'm sorry.
When are you going to be able to get this online so people have time to look at it before we vote it?
Get it online as soon as you want to get it online. Tomorrow morning? Talking about the budget we're talking about?
Yeah.
Well, you know how back in the old days, you know, like last year?
It was a long time ago, you know.
Seems like eons, yes. When we were discussing the budget, there would be pages and pages of Excel spreadsheets that would have the proposed budget, would have this year's budget, actual versus budgeted, and would have history a few years back and some percentage increase columns and stuff. So we sort of...
We did it in the last few meetings, so...
But you saw it, but what else...
There were meetings and it was on the agenda, I think, so... It was the same book.
Right.
We just added stuff to it.
So if I did not sit, it did not come to the meeting, though.
Yeah.
I did not have an opportunity to see it because it was nowhere other than on the projector.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And my last question is, if you're going to go with the DART comparisons
mm-hmm.
at town meeting, you need to be extremely clear on how those school districts are selected, because Hamilton-Wenham is 1,800 students and Westford is 5,100 students. Canton is the lowest per pupil for the principal and instructional administration or whatever that thing is. Hamilton-Wenham is more than twice the per pupil cost. They are 1 and 2 in terms of the lowest cost when you multiply student
yep.
times per pupil cost. So that chart doesn't real to me it was like it didn't really say anything, and those are the kind of expenses that don't scale the way that that like the salary items do, because you have a superintendent whether you have 1,000 students or 5,000
right.
students
mm-hmm.
and you know your cost per pupil is going to be way different, so it's I didn't find that at all meaningful or informative.
See, Maureen, that's the issue we have is, you know, the crazy thinking.
And also, you know, Duxbury, Scituate, you know, that
yeah, but,
people don't.
Yeah, but just because it's local, just because AB is down the road, aren't we really?
No, but right, but it's sort
on
of.
On the other extreme.
Right.
But, you know, the Pembroke, Scituate, and Duxbury, I have absolutely no sense of those towns. You know, what are we comparing to other than some number? Whereas
mm-hmm.
things that are closer,
mm-hmm.
You know, something like, I would say the Route 3 to the Turnpike as the spokes going 128 to 190 and extending the 190 line would get, somewhere in that region would give us more of a sense of, you know, what they're talking about when you're comparing to Burlington.
So I'm calling you tomorrow. We'll have a conversation, and then I will call you, George, and Dr. Bates,
mm-hmm.
because I think I need to hear from you.
I completely agree with Maureen on that. I mean, it's insane, I think, that the state uses what they use for DART. But if we're, as citizens, going to then look for comparisons, that's the only thing that DESE's
right.
going to give
but,
for us.
But
we need to establish otherwise
right.
what towns do we want to hold ourselves
well,
to and not... make a moving target and
but
then say these are the towns and then annually compare. So
right,
I
but
totally
it's even,
agree.
It's even fine to go with the DART if people understand that they're comparing us by percentages of
right,
ELL,
the characteristics.
Percentage of
right.
low
that's
income
right.
or whatever.
Right.
And I think that needs to be clear because not everybody's going to go
yeah,
on.
Yeah, it's going
to
be different.
We
right.
spent
right.
last night going through, you know, juggling things to see what compared and
okay. I'm going to call you. And then I'll circulate something to everyone here. One second. I'm sorry, Stasha. And then, George, we probably need to get this up online now that we're kind of so close. I think it's time to put it out in a draft format.
With the changes from tonight, right?
Yes, please, with the changes from tonight. Hello.
Hello. Awesome. Thank you. I appreciate you asking that question because I was looking for that document and to come prepared to
oh,
this meeting.
Oh, I thought you were, okay.
Yep, and thank you, that it will be posted soon is a good answer. But because you guys have actually seen it, I have just two very, very quick questions for you, and I'm not looking for any long explanation. Maybe we'll have that next
please,
week.
Please, no one, right?
is there a line in there for OPEB this year?
Oh, Mark, what did we do?
Last week.
I suggested that we do 25,000, and you wanted to do the difference between something else.
I wanted to do the difference in the full-time SRO to the 180 days SRO.
It was 22.
I'll go with, oh, God, guys, we have to talk about OPEB. We got to do something.
I thought we were going to put like 20.
Are you good?
Yeah, you did talk about it.
We said like 20-ish.
20-ish was the word.
It was
20,000
or
25. Well, Mark's
if I were to pick a number, I'd choose 25, because it's a nice round number.
It's an easy target for the following year to surpass. It's like goal setting, right?
So is this additional, or is there an offset for it?
George, where can you find an offset for us?
I would offset the that wasn't taken out. Was I would offset the police officer.
Oh, that's right.
And
it's
25 then?
No, it was 22. So he's going to find another $3,000 offset.
Mark is really pushing for discussing the OPEB, and truly that's something that's on like the finance subcommittee's agenda.
Okay.
But it's a long conversation. This
I know, that's why I prefaced my question with just a short answer. That's all I wanted to know, and I appreciate that it's being looked at.
And you add another one?
Yeah, good. My other one was, do you have a number for END right now?
George?
1.3, low 1.3s.
Thank you.
That's good.
Is that before or after we use it? Before we use it.
Yes.
And Mary Lee, did you have a question?
Well, no, I don't want to go into that. Thank you. I'm not going to go into
that. You sure?
Yeah.
Will you
let
one of us know?
I will. I already sent her a graph.
You didn't share it.
Well, it basically compares our administrative and guidance and instructional leadership, you know, with a whole bunch of towns based on size and looking at things. And I think Algonquin is one that probably would be more in our demographic.
Yeah.
And I think it speaks to people that know. And I don't see why we can't show the DART numbers and at the bottom have a few local towns.
So that's what we were talking about. Throw three more on there that are representative.
Right.
Algonquin's a good one. That's good. Will you think about it too and send me a couple?
Okay, it's a mess.
I don't care.
Sorry.
I'm good with it. Okay. Anybody else? All right, I hope I do this right, because we need to now close the public hearing.
I move we close the public hearing.
Thank you. Do we have a second?
Second.
I think we need to close the whole meeting. All those in favor?
Aye.
Unanimous. And do we need to close the regular meeting, Mark?
Yeah. Yeah. Item chair to get on our list.
We don't have to. We're not. I mean, we're meeting next week at 6:00. All right. Yeah. Somebody make a motion to close the regular meeting, because I think we really needed to close the regular meeting.
Second.
All those in favor? Kathy.
Hi, Don.
Theo. Lynn.
I don't want to be rude.
Lynn, thank you for taking minutes. Thank you all. What?
She did.
We just